If I went to Ghana today and I spoke to 2,000 Ghanaians, right? Yeah. And I asked them, do you know that Yoruba people stoop down when they meet elders? What percentage of that do you think will say, yeah, I know that?
But I'm not in Accra.
That's not what I'm asking you. I said, I'll ask you a particular question.
I wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know. You wouldn't know a percentage. You have, okay, give me a rough estimate guess.
No, I wouldn't want to presume.
So you wouldn't want to presume. So you just, you have not, you're ignorant to everything in your country.
No, it's not about me.
Last time when what's her name was here, you knew everything about Ghana. I'm asking you a question now. Sally, I don't know. I don't know.
I think that you're being.
I don't know.
Piers Wahala Morgan.
I don't know.
No, Wahala, I think that you're being like. Let me try. I think that you're just being difficult.
No, I'm not. I'm asking you a valid question.
Facetious is the word you're
looking
for.
I'm asking you a valid question.
Wahala, I think that's an unfair question, okay?
I didn't ask you whether it's unfair. Can you answer the question?
Wait, whoa, go on, let him finish. Wait. No one wants to answer it.
You can't answer that question because she said that she's not based, okay, in Accra. And so, okay, she can't make it. If you bring it to London, then that's a different kind of like thing.
Well, I'm asking about London.
Why are you still asking the question?
Puny people.
I don't have questions. I'm saying you can give me a rough estimate.
She doesn't know.
Wahala, I don't know. But what's the number? I don't know. But what's the estimate? I don't know.
Yes. Second time around. This is episode 298 of the Eloquently Saying Nothing podcast.
Say nothing.
Hashtag ESN pod to start or join in the conversation at ESN podcast on all the social medias. For those of you in the clubhouse room, use the hashtag ESN pod and the link that's around somewhere on all the
social
medias.
Do it right now.
Yeah. Yes. On all the social medias. Invite people into the room because it's empty like my life.
Plug.
Aye.
Because we're late, bruv.
Potentially. I doubt it, but who knows? Anyways. Where was I?
Yes.
I am Stavros Boss. Get down! And you can catch me at Stavros Boss on all the social medias. In front of me, I have my brother, Big Wahala.
At Big Wahala on Insta, Big Wahala on Twitter. What's good, people?
Smash! Thank you very much, sir.
Yes.
To my left, I have... Mr. Wolf.
What's going on? I'm a happy Liverpool fan. It's always sweet.
Well, your team's still shit.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter, though, always, innit?
Let him have it. Go on.
It's always sweet when we beat the Arsenal, innit? You know what I mean? So,
we are the longest running rivalry for...
It is, innit?
Yeah, I think it is.
Mad thing.
There was Jesus and Judas, and then there was
Liverpool and Arsenal.
was Judas his rival?
Well, you know.
It's his brother.
He turned on him.
Did God not make him turn on him?
He just knew it was going
to
happen.
Exactly. So if God knew it was going to happen, why did you put a stop to this? If you knew that one of your brothers was going to turn on you and you knew he would do it, would you stop him?
No, your brother, your son.
No, your brother,
no,
Judas.
His brother. God. Jesus.
No, we're talking about Jesus. Jesus knew that Judas was going to turn on him. If you was Jesus at the time, would you have said to Judas?
No, he wouldn't.
Pause.
He would say, I told you so. I knew you would crucify me. I knew I was going to be happy because of you.
I can't remember. Judas committed suicide after, innit? As well, innit?
Apparently.
You're a fool.
No, anyway. Answer his question, though, for real, though.
Would I? I don't know. I'd probably just leave you to it, bruv.
To let me die?
Because there's a whole thing behind it, innit?
All right, let's get back to that. Sorry. Let's get back to that afterwards. Go on, answer this. Your intro. I'm sorry, my G. My brother.
No, you don't have to apologize.
Baba.
This is what we do, innit?
Baba.
That's
sorry.
Dobale. Do you know what I'm saying?
There's been a whole beef about that online, you know?
Really?
Yeah.
I've been showing my son and my daughter about that. My daughter does it quite well. I think we mentioned that in the past. And I was out yesterday and one of my friends was speaking to my kids about it. And we had a good discussion, man. It was good.
There was a big thing about it, but we can get into that.
Yeah, we'll finish the intros and we'll get into that.
Yeah. Anyway. What's going on, people? It's your boy, Mr. Wolf, in the building. Good to be here. We got this week's Yoruba proverb as per usual, and it goes like this. Eni ti ko dukbe egbefa, bi igi di ono egbeji.
All right, that was silky. I'm not going to lie to you. The way you just flowed into that one, I like that one still.
I'll have to practice. I have to practice.
I don't know if it's accurate, but it was good.
I was thinking.
It is.
I felt like.
Because I've got someone who helps me with the translations now. Yeah. So more time is going to be accurate than, you know.
But it's not the problem is not the how it sounds to you.
It's the enunciation.
It's how it sounds to them, bro.
And that's fine. And
that's the issue, man.
Yeah, it's not even pronunciation. It's enunciation. Yes.
And what I've done is
I would bet
that
my left toe that you said it wrong.
Well, I would bet my left toe that
don't do it, bro.
I would because what I've done.
Don't do it.
What I've done is that I've sent a voice note back to the individual, and they've been very happy with my attempt.
Are they elders?
Yeah, but are they happy with your attempt on the basis that you're English speaking first and you've done it, or are they happy with your attempt as, you know, this can pass?
It's either right or wrong.
There's some people that are on this part of Yoruba land that sound like you, and there's some that don't.
There's no in between.
Okay.
And there's some nice Nigerians who have an in between because it's like, I'll allow you.
But I trust Mr. Wolf that the person that he's talking to would have a rectify him.
He's a very good man, and I consider him to be an older brother. He doesn't like it when I call him uncle. You understand?
He's the one that doesn't like being called uncle.
He's born and bred back home, innit?
But he's a new age Nigerian.
No, man, he's a Niger man, a proper Yoruba man.
But if he doesn't want you to call him uncle,
how much older is he to you?
Listen, he's a proper man, innit, that has heard what I've said and is happy with it. So just leave it there.
I'm just interested about the uncle thing. So how old is he more than you?
About 10 years.
Why? And he doesn't wanna hold that title.
Maybe he
makes him feel old himself.
He would prefer me to call him brother and then his name.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But anyway, the translation is whoever is not grateful for small favors blocks the path to bigger ones. And the wisdom translation is attitude of gratitude is it. Kindness calls for gratitude, and gratitude beckons on more kindness. You know, and was teaching the kids yesterday that your attitude could take you to places, whether it's a good one or a bad one. So whatever your attitude is, it could take you down two paths.
But
you know,
just be careful, you know, because where we work, I know that the worst attitude is the people that seem to fly up.
It depends on what you define as the worst attitude.
Oh man, not that they get the job done and they have a bad attitude. They just have a bad attitude.
Yeah, but what?
And it's like they move people. It's because it's like, I don't want you working with me, and you want this promotion. They hustle. Don't get me wrong. So they try and move up. But part of that moving up is like they're not nice people, and people are like, I don't want you working with me, so go up. And they give them the rice. They give them the thing.
I don't want my kids to be like that. I think it happens everywhere in life. I think that your attitude will determine your altitude. Generally, you know what I mean? But
as a football coach,
I would play with them bars, you know
man? Yeah, man.
Listen to me, lads. Your attitude, whatever he says about attitude.
And I have been a coach as well, so that is a part of my makeup.
That's football coach talking, man.
Part of my makeup. But anyway, man, you can catch me on Instagram on AKA Mr. Wolf, on Twitter on AKA_Mr. Wolf. What is going on? What's going on?
I was on the Insta and I was trying to actually follow just us. So I've unfollowed everyone else apart from your missus. And I was trying to just follow us guys, and I couldn't find you. I had to find you via some next method. And even myself, it's like if I put my name into Instagram, nothing comes up.
Are you blocked? Are you private?
I'm not private. I don't think so. Anyways,
I'm not a private man.
You're not a private account.
Mr. Wolf, AKA Mr. Wolf.
Can you like one of ESN's tickets so I could actually just follow you because it won't let me follow you. All right. To my immediate right, we have the lost soul, the wandering son, our brother, your brother, DJ Webslinger.
DJ Webslinger on Instagram, DJ Webslinger on Twitter. Back from a mission or two.
Wearing shades in the midlight.
Yeah. I wear my sunglasses.
It's not bad outside.
Night.
It's not bad.
It was blinging outside.
It's cold though.
It is cold, but it was nicely sunny though.
It's near.
It was in the car though. It's really warm.
It was.
Yeah,
that's because you're in the car.
No, the sun was hitting the window.
No, but it's right. It's because you're in the car. I'm just saying. This one's playing stuff over the microphone.
Rego, like no one can hear it.
My name is J.R. Hartley.
Listen, I've had someone who's actually listening to us now, and they're saying that we don't sound very clear. So
yeah, because I'm trying to finish, so I can put this in the middle, so we can sound clear.
Okay,
I'm always trying to do things. But
all right. Let us do our intro, and then we'll sound better.
Thank you very much.
Well,
we have last but not least, filling out the five fingers of positivity,
Voltron,
and life, and Voltron. We have Simple Simon.
Mm-hmm. I forgot the poem. I did. Hang on. Freestyle. I'm on a telephone call to one that I would consider to be my lover. Mm-hmm. This telephone call is not plutonic in any way, shape, or form. Mm-hmm. We are talking up the things. Mm. Gaza. That was a short excerpt from a poem.
Very short.
Very, very short excerpt from a poem from the Right Honourable Patra. In its original rendition, the poem is called Romantic Carl, and it's sung a little something like this, yeah. Them not ready for them, yeah.
Turn that shit up, bro. I remember seeing Patra back in the day, you know.
I don't understand that.
I'm a romantic girl. I'm a baby. My friend, shut up.
I'm singing my song, bruv. Where's Yo-Yo?
Big Wahala's here dancing.
You know this is my spice, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
I love Patra.
You love Patra.
Welcome to the ESN Podcast.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. I'm loving it. That's why. For real.
You know the people here can't hear that.
I know. I'm sorry.
I'm a romantic girl.
I'm sorry. Yeah, so that was Patra, Romantic Carl. I am Simple Simon at Simple Simon FB on Twitter. I don't have Instagram. Gaza, we say forever. Alliance at the Foundation. Bang. Bang.
Dogs, rodents, and other small insects. Welcome.
Lock off. All right. When was the last time that you was on a romantic call?
I haven't had one of those in donkeys, man.
When was the last time you called your woman, even when you was away from her, and had a romantic call with her?
Yeah, I'm shit at that. I haven't done it for time.
What do you consider a romantic call?
Oh, yeah, I talk up to sitting there, innit? In the dark. In the dark room.
Saying something nice. And dark. Sweat.
How about you, Big Wahala?
Nah, I don't do.
You don't do things like that, do you?
I don't do that. I don't.
It's your people, innit?
Fine. Talk. Just leave it. What? Carry on. Anyway, say we are, sir. Anyway, Mr. Stabby Stab, you got to do your hosting piece, so talk up the things, my G.
Thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Eloquently Say Nothing podcast. This week, we're recording live on Clubhouse, Monday, whatever, in April.
Monday, 5th of April.
Everyone's just been filing out the room, so we only have a couple of people left. Nana, if you'd like to introduce yourself, and then anybody that wants to talk, by all means, let them talk.
No problem. So, hi, my name's Elaine on these Clubhouse streets, but they'll hear you on for the purposes of the podcast. You'll also hear people calling me by...
Listen, no one asked you to introduce yourself, fam. Just bring people into the room. Look at her.
That is exactly what I asked her to.
Why? Why are you asking her to introduce herself? That's how she thinks she's part of the crew. That's how she's going to try and take money when we get money as well.
Listen, I have tried to help you protection. Get money, but you guys really don't want it. So anyway, as they might be transcribing the room as well, and also because of the fact that the podcast, you're going to have people who aren't normally on it. If before you speak, if you could say that who's speaking, and once you finish speaking, that would also be great as well, just to go with the flow. So as I said, if I was rudely interrupted by somebody who I know the voice very well, I'm Mr. Wahala. Wahala by name, Wahala by nature. My name is also Nana, and I'm here to help Stavros moderate this room. So I'm going to pass over to Neve and Dee, then Asha, and then we'll go over to your first topic, Stav, if that's okay. So, Neve, would you like to introduce yourself?
What's good, people? I'm Neve.
Big up, my G.
Yeah, Neve, your man of few words.
Get to the point.
Anyone else?
Dee, then Asha, and we've got a couple of other people in the room as well, but then you can start talking, Stav.
Hey, I am D Brave, aka 52 Weeks Later. Good afternoon, happy Easter. And I'd just like to say that Jesus didn't die yesterday or rise yesterday for Wahala to treat Nana like a brute.
Well, if you don't want me to start being offensive to people, I suggest you don't even bring that to my attention in the first place.
Wow.
But it's
pick
all
up
right.
Pick up yourself, D. Standard.
Thanks. I'll be offensive. I don't mind.
Thanks for joining us, Steve. I'll tell your mum.
drum. You don't want that drummer.
Exactly. Yeah, I don't want that beat.
You don't want that drummer.
Anointed oil will come straight out, boy.
Yeah.
What do you mean he didn't rise? What do you mean?
I WhatsApped the audio recording, you know. I won't even tell her what he's saying.
What's your sweat, you bastard?
Web singer, what are you talking about?
There's one last person, Asha.
Hi everyone, I'm Asha. I'm here with my sister, so we're both tuning in, but thank you for having us. I have my own podcast with my co-host.
Plug it.
Yeah. it's called the Main Squeeze Podcast. You can find it on all the usual platforms. And it's a pleasure to be here with you guys.
I'm going to get disrespectful. It's called the Main Squeeze Podcast. Does that mean it's the side pieces that are all on this podcast talking about what it's like to be a main, or is it the other way around? I'm just saying.
Something like that. It has got a story, but it's got a story to it. But with the main squeeze in it, with the main piece.
All right, cool. All right. Big up yourself still. I like it.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. And shout out to the sister who's not talking. For, I'm assuming, good reasons. I know she don't like talking, innit? One of them ones.
Sister.
All right, I've done, so that's not going to make any noise. Okay, guys, what were you talking about now? They can carry on talking about what you're talking about. Thanks. Now that I've said my,
I can't remember
done my thing.
What are you talking about?
Well, what was it we were talking about just before we started recording then? This thing about, Dobale.
Dobale,
Dobale.
So what are you saying about it now?
Do you want to explain what it is?
I'm ashamed of you sometimes.
Just be ashamed of me. I'm not a real Nigerian. I'm wearing all these clothes to make up for the fact
that you know exactly what you did as well.
I'm wearing all these clothes.
What's his guy name then?
Yao.
Whoa. Don't have to be offensive.
Kwabana.
Just saying, isn't it?
Kwabana.
Can you...
is that offensive? Are we not always offensive on
there? I think he's joking.
Is he?
What were people complaining about this week, Wala?
There was a little video that actually played to my mum yesterday, actually, about she was a girl, basically, that had, did I put it in the group? I didn't think I put it in our group. No. So there's a video where a girl just made a joke about how your friends come to greet your Nigerian parents, yeah? And, she had three different girls come in. One of them just said, I can play it, actually, to be honest, if you want me to, but it's a bit long, if you can't see it. But anyway, one girl comes in and just says, hi, and then the mum's like, hi. Hi, your mother.
No, your mother is high.
Your mother is high. That's it. That's what she said. And then another one came in and was like, hi, auntie. How are you doing? And she goes, how? And the girl's like, hi. And the mom's like, hi, how are you? And she's like, I'm fine, auntie. How are you? And then she got angry about the fact she asked her, how are you? This is one I never heard before. So that one I never understood. And then the next one came in. And then she came in and she actually, she came in and she couldn't live for her. And that was, she stooped down. Well, she curtsied, basically.
Did she not go fully on the knees?
She might have gone fully on the knees, to pray.
Need to explain what this is to those in the room that don't know what it is.
Let me explain the actual thing first, and then I'll explain after what happened.
All right.
Yeah? So then she does that, and then the mum gets really, really happy, and she's like, oh, my daughter, yeah, I've brought a good friend here to the house, blah, 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 blah. And it's a joke. Now, in Nigerian culture, which I think we've discussed previously in the past.
Many times.
In Yoruba culture, because there's Igbo people around that will look at me like, is this my own?
Mm-hmm.
We don't do this.
We don't do this in Igbo land.
We don't do this here.
In Igbo land.
But in Yoruba culture, we tend to, if we are meeting elders of a certain stature, and or people of a certain stature, it doesn't have to necessarily even be elders, but it's most likely elders or somebody of a stature, we tend to do something that we call Dobale, or we do, it's kunle for women as well, isn't it? That's what they call it. Where men will basically have us go all the way down to the floor to prostrate, or they might just put their finger to the floor. And a lady will do what you be an equivalent of a curtsy and get back up. So a bit like what the roles do when people see royalty, exactly when they
what
bow
you,
down.
What you would do to meet the queen is what you do to meet an elder in Yoruba culture.
Basically. But there was a whole back and forth because the video came out and it was just a joke. But then obviously people from different cultures were like, "What are you lot doing? What is this? You people are mad. Yada yada yada. Are you think I'm doing this for anyone's family? Yada yada yada." And it was just one of those situations where everyone, it's different from maybe where it's diaspora wars, where it's maybe Caribbean versus Africa. This was Europe versus the world, because it's only Europe people that actually does it, really. That you see in bulk doing it.
But there's been Europe people that is not
On it either.
They're not, because it's like, I don't want to do it myself. So I'm not going to force anybody else to do it to my parents.
But it's the people that are going to be defending it is usually your other people.
Well, you don't want to do it yourself.
No, not me personally. No, okay. I said.
It does look a bit wild though. The Dubai, the male one. You just basically hoover the floor with your clothes.
Yeah, but no, I don't think many people do it like that anymore.
But then you'll have some people that have a problem with that in the first place. Like, why don't you do it the proper way?
Am I not enough?
I don't know anybody.
This is on a personal level that like aunties, uncles, or elders that will have a problem with you doing a half dobale. So the half one is basically you kind of touching your toe, so to speak. So that's you kind of going down. I don't know anyone that has had an issue with that. When you're meeting like royalty, or like I remember when what's his name? Wizkid and Anthony Joshua met
the king,
a king, and I think it was certain government members. You get me? They done the full dobale where they get down flat. But when you're meeting kind of uncles or aunties or certain elders, I've never known anybody to have a really issue with that. That's just me personally, and that's me even going back home. The last time that I went back home, there was no major issue in it.
The only time it's expected, I think, is if it's a traditional wedding.
Yeah,
I don't see what the issue is. There's so many different cultures that have different greeting methods.
Yeah,
people will either give each other two or three kisses. People will hug.
That's the Japanese people. They bow.
Yeah. But that's again, it's not. That's why I said it's only the male one, because that
you sound westernized.
That one, yeah, maybe I am.
You sound like the white,
sound British.
It's just the whole laying out flat. It's because I've seen some white garment just get destroyed
scattered
as well.
Yeah, but when have you seen somebody there?
Me,
yeah.
In Nigeria, I see it in Nigeria all the time.
But when,
like, generally when somebody's coming, they've come in to greet an elder or what have you. Sometimes it's the boys off the street. They come to greet the elder.
I've never seen anyone do it that ever done it full. Like,
I've seen it, man. I've seen it on my street.
I've only ever seen it do it. Is it the village?
No, on my street in Nigeria. I've seen it. In Lagos, yeah, I've seen it.
I've never really seen anybody do it full, unless it's, as again, somebody of like a proper age or.
No, I've seen it.
Or like, it's an important situation. But it was just interesting to see the amount of back and forth. So I played the video to my mum anyway, and she was just like laughing or whatever. But she was like, the second one, she just didn't understand. And even me, I didn't understand. She's like, and a lot of people were saying, I don't know if this is a different thing, because I saw a lot of Ghanaian people saying this one as well, that saying, how are you back to an elder is seen as disrespectful.
You know, actually, I was speaking to one of my colleagues who's a Nigerian, and he was talking about respect and how his similar thing, how what he expects from his children's friends when they come to the house. And so he said something similar to this. This is about a year ago now. I think it was just the start of COVID. And he was saying, basically, if they come disrespectful, whatever. But, you know, he understands these people, they're not of our culture. So he understands this, things are going to be different. But he said that there's times when they come. And for him, which is similar to what you're saying, the disrespectful thing was when they try and like initiate the greeting in his own house.
No. In the video, it's different.
Yeah, okay, then.
Because she said, the mom asked, how are you?
Yes.
And then she replies, I'm fine. And then she asked her, how are you back?
Okay.
So that's not initiating the greeting in the video, but carry on. Okay.
So what he didn't like is that you shouldn't come to me and stick your hand out and try and shake my hand. I should come and try and shake your hand.
In his own house?
Yeah.
That don't make sense to me.
Well,
if somebody's coming into my house, surely they're the ones that should be initiating the greeting to move me, because you're entering my house.
Because he's, how did he put it? It's like you don't know how we should greet in this house, because you shouldn't be shaking my hand in, for first of all, anyways. So you're doing it wrong. So if you're gonna come to somebody's house and wait for that greeting, then allow me to initiate it as the man of the house.
See,
that was his reason.
But if that's his children, that's his children's fault. It's their fault.
Yeah, but he told his. Then he said that Then he told his son, when your friends come, you know, I don't expect them to be doing this and this and this, but they can't just come walk into, what's up, hello uncle, and then stick their hand out. It's like, no. You say hello uncle, you wait there, and then you allow me to stick my hand out, and that is, as far as he's concerned, that's a sign of respect, that you stand there humbly waiting for, how is it, should I greet you? And then you stick out that?
Listen, this is brought up something interesting for me. Obviously, we're coming into that time now where we're going to be the generation where our children's friends are going to be coming to the house,
yes,
and whatever. What's your standpoint on on this greeting thing? Do you have any regulations?
You're looking at me.
Yeah. And Mr. Wolf, have you got any regulations? Have you got any standards around it? What's your expectations when your children's friends come to the yard?
My expectation is whatever you taught your children, then that's what they should be doing. So I'm not expecting them to do it. But if they do it, I am not one of these uncles. No, stand up. That's part of our culture. So if you do it, I mean, in your case, it's the other side. Well, if they do it, all good. If they don't, and it's not important to you, or you don't think they need to do it, or I'm not old enough, because you might see this man is my age, do it with people my mum's age, you know, that kind of thing. Then that's your thing. I will teach my daughter to do it. Well, we started teaching and then we stopped, especially, you know, she doesn't really meet too many outsiders, but I'll teach her to do it. I don't know. The age group is the question thing.
No, but it's not about her doing it. It's about her friends coming to your yard.
No, but I've just said, my daughter's friends.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Well, I just class you because she's so young. That's me now thinking that 20 years down the line.
Yeah.
Or 15 years down the line.
15 years?
Do you have any idea what your attitude is going to be, man, towards it?
Well, 10 years.
10 years, she's going to be bringing people 12 home.
Yeah, friends, man. Even earlier than that.
Yeah, friends will come over.
It would be the same thing then. If a 14-year-old, 15-year-old comes to my house and is somebody, I'm talking about you guys because I know you guys. Yeah. And I know your children.
Yeah.
So I'm fully like, well, is this how you taught your children? If it's some person that she brought home from school, then what am I expecting from them?
Oh, okay.
Just to be respectful, I'm not expecting all of that stuff from somebody.
But if your daughter has trained, she would have trained them well to come to the house and behave.
Not necessarily, because I might tell her I'm not expecting that from outsiders.
Okay, then
because I might tell my daughter, if you go to a Yoruba's house, then you do it. But if you want to tell your daughter, your friend, to do that when they come to me as a Yoruba person, that's fine. But I'm not expecting everybody to be teaching their child.
No,
Mr. Wolf, what are you saying?
Yeah, I'm of the same kind of boat as Stavros there. I think it depends on the culture, innit? Not every culture is going to be about that. And if they have friends, if my kids have friends, you know, my son is 17 now, my daughter's 11. So if they have friends and they want to teach their friends to do that to me and their friends are cool with it, then I'm like, okay, cool. Or if they are going to be around their grandparents, because they're around their grandparents a lot, and if their friends are around their grandparents and they feel that it's the right thing to do, you know, you're my bridge and I want you to do this for my grandma or my granddad, then boom. But I'm not expecting them to. You know what I mean? All that is important to me is just a level of respect. If you know, you got to know who you're dealing with here. I'm not one of your bridges. So I don't want my daughter's friend or my son's friend to be talking to me like I'm one of the mandem. I ain't. And I'm quite, you know, staunch when it comes to respecting elders. You know what I mean? I don't consider myself to be an old man, but I am your dad. You get me? You're funny.
Can I just ask a question?
Go ahead.
Please? No, you can't.
And that is, it's Elaine here. And that is that when you were young, did you tell your friends this when they came to your house? Because I have had many a Nigerian friend. I have had many Yoruba friends, and nobody to this day has told me that when I go to visit my Nigerian friends that I should be doing whatever to their parents.
No, I mean...
They might have thought that you would know better.
Like I said...
Why would I know better? I'm not Nigerian.
Yeah, but like I said, I'm not expecting the girl, like my daughter or my son's friends, to do that. And to be honest, I personally didn't tell any of my bridgings to do that when they're around my parents. So if they were of a if they were the same culture as me and they were Yoruba people, then perhaps I would maybe not really so much expect, but if they did it, then it's cool. If they didn't, like my parents are cool. They wouldn't look at you and think that why haven't you gone down. It's more just make sure that you treat me with respect, innit? I'm, you know, big Wahala's parent. I'm Mr. Wolf's parent. Make sure that you come to my house and you respect me. Don't be calling me by my first name and things like that.
I told them, boy, don't make eye contact. Don't make eye contact. Don't extend your left hand unless you want to die. If it was a woman, I was like, you
don't take anything with the left hand. Yeah, that's like, that's our culture.
And this person's name is Sa. That's the name for you, Sa. Don't say anything else. You say yes, sir. No, sir. Okay, sir. That's it. You got to prep them. You got to prep your friends.
When I first met your dad, I stooped down for him.
Yeah, you stooped down for him.
And he said, and he was like, you don't do that.
he was kind of, but he still respected it. He then he brought me up and he shook my hand.
Yeah,
like he said, blah blah blah. But he still acknowledged the fact that I was doing it because he knows it's part of my culture.
Yeah, exactly.
So what I was saying with regards to you, Elaine, with regards to why I was saying that they thought you might have known better, is because as much as we know it's a Yoruba thing, I just think that people from most African nations or West Africans, especially Ghanaians, will probably know that Yoruba people do it. So maybe they won't expect you to do it.
Really?
Yeah, I would expect that they know that Yoruba people do it. They see Yoruba people are seen quite often. It's like a thing. Whether or not they do it or not, I don't think that they. I think they know that Yoruba people do it.
No, let me. Let's ask.
I think that it's wrong to assume, and the reason why I'd say that it's wrong to assume is because you might be one of the larger tribes from Nigeria, it doesn't mean that other people actually care. And so if they don't care when it comes to these things, like we don't learn each other's languages as much as we should compared to learning English and French and all the other European languages, we don't necessarily, even within our own, well, I can only speak for Ghana for myself, as somebody who's of Ashanti descent, I can't even tell you what somebody who is Ever does or what somebody who is Hausa does. So why would I, when Ghana is actually two countries away from Nigeria, Boko, when we might not necessarily have that much intermarriage as well, when if it wasn't for I don't watch Nollywood films as well.
Mahouye.
So there are
you don't really see Nollywood films really either, but that's another thing.
And so if it's not been shown in our media, and if it's not that we haven't necessarily had to interact, it's actually quite foolhardy. But I think...
quick question then, just on that. If I went to Ghana today, and I went to, I don't know, where's your, Accra, yeah? Which is the capital, or have you changed your capital
Accra.
Now?
Accra's the capital.
All right, and I went to them, and I spoke to 2,000 Ghanaians. Right,
yeah.
And I asked them, "Do you know that Yoruba people stoop down when they meet elders? What percentage of that do you think will say, yeah, I know that?"
But I'm not in Accra.
That's not what I'm asking you. I said I'll ask you a particular question.
I wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know a percentage. You have okay. Give me a rough estimate guess.
No, I wouldn't want to presume.
So you wouldn't want to presume. So you're ignorant to everything in your country.
No, it's not about me.
Last time, when Wasade was here, you knew everything about Ghana. I'm asking you a question now. Sally, I don't know. I don't know.
I think that you're being.
I don't know.
Piers Wahala Morgan.
I don't know.
No, Wahala, I think that you're being like. Let me try and. I think that you're just being difficult.
No, I'm not. I'm asking you a valid question.
Facetious is the word you're looking
for. I'm asking you a valid question.
No, but the thing is.
Because you made it about yourself.
No.
Because we were talking about you.
I've asked you about your. If you guys have told your friends this, and I'm saying this as somebody who has had Nigerian friends that my friends didn't tell me, so I am making it about myself because I haven't been told.
Yeah, and I was saying that that somebody may have presumed that because you're from Ghana, that you might have known. And you're saying, well, I should have made that assumption, which I said, fine. But then I'm asking you as a rough estimate, how many, if you were to ask 2,000 people in Ghana, in Accra, sorry, right? That Yoruba people stoop down. I'm just asking you as a rough estimate, how many people do you think would know? And the reason I'm asking is because I think it would be more known than you probably think.
I don't know, but maybe Ni and some of the others on the stage might be able to also answer that question.
Wahala, I think that's an unfair question. Okay,
I didn't ask you whether it was unfair. Can you answer the question?
Wait, whoa, go on, let him finish. Wait, no one wants to answer it.
You can't answer that question because she said that she's not based again in Accra. And so, okay, she can't make it. If you bring it to London, then that's a different kind of like thing.
Well, I'm asking about London. I'm asking about
puny Ghanas.
I'm asking about Ghana.
Yeah, but she
you're asking about Ghana, and she's saying, okay, she doesn't know. Yeah, so why are you still asking the question?
Puny people.
I don't have questions. I'm saying you can give me a rough estimate.
She doesn't know.
Wahala, I don't know. But what's the number? I don't know. But what's the estimate? I don't know.
So, okay, except so you know nothing about your country. It's fine.
It's not that they don't know nothing.
That's not that.
All right, look.
I'm being generally honest because
last time we was
having a conversation
puny Ghanaians
about Ghana. Yes,
yeah.
She was very vocal about Ghana, about things that was happening in Ghana. Yeah. Right.
Well,
so she hold on. So let me finish. So she knew about Ghana then. So I'm asking her a question that I think is something that I would think she would have at least an idea about.
She told you the last conversation, she told you, okay, because she knew about it. Now, okay, she's saying that she doesn't know.
Yeah, but I'm saying...
that she doesn't know.
No, I think she's got an idea.
Don't try and conflate it, okay, and say that she doesn't know.
I don't think you should speak for a woman.
Wow. He's out here doing...
I'm not speaking for a woman. It's just that you're not listening, okay, to a woman. So sometimes, okay, it's better, okay, when a man says it because...
I'm not listening to you either, so it don't make no difference.
he's being ultimately facetious. No, but on
listen,
a level.
Hold on, just before we go, listen, I know 52 weeks later very, very well. So please don't take it as me causing this guy problems. This man is my actual problem in my life. So that's why I'm talking to him like this. Big up yourself, Mr. 52 weeks later.
Puny 52.
But I do think both of you have an idea though, and you're just not saying.
No, do you know what? I would say, okay, if you ask the question about London, okay, I can give you a better answer, okay, than Accra.
I'm gonna go with what both Nana and are saying. No, but the reason why I'm saying that is because I'm sitting here thinking now, do I know what the traditional greeting of any Ghanaian tribe is? And I've got Ghanaian friends. I don't know if they have any special handshake. I don't know if they have any special gesture that goes with the greeting or any of that.
Mm-hmm.
So for me,
it's a good point.
This is what I was gonna say.
We're two countries over, and I don't know that.
Do you know how to greet? If you were to meet my wife's family in Ghana right now.
Do you?
After I've told you, do you even remember them? Because I've said it. Do you remember?
I don't remember because they're insignificant.
Wow.
Not the family, just the Ghanaians.
Wow.
Puny Ghanaians.
So the Ghanaians. The Ghanaians that are on the stage, let me try and bring you into the conversation a bit. So when I went to Ghana and I met my wife's family, I was explained to this is how you, because I met them as a collective, there was a group, I went to the family home. And there was a bunch of them, elders and people my age, but it didn't matter. There was a certain way I should greet them. Is there one of you that could explain to me how I should greet them? Yeah, well, let the Ghanaian speak before
which,
I say the wrong
which
way.
Ethnic group is your wife's family from?
She's a mongrel. She's a mix of a bunch of them. But
he called his wife a mongrel.
Well, that's the definition of it, isn't it?
Wow. But
Fanti was like I would say the
dominant.
Yeah, that's what she's claiming.
Which one is the one that the Greek is for? Or do you not know?
I don't know. This is the thing as well. This is how I had to greet the family, and I didn't necessarily know even which tribe it was for. So, if there's different tribes that do different greetings, different ways, it's in particular for adults, something that's likened to this, if you could explain to us which ones that you know of. You don't have to talk about the ones.
I think my knowledge of greetings is mostly with like contextual stuff. So more like marriage things, that kind of stuff.
Mm.
I think... In general, and I could be mistaken, but I don't think in Ghana we have, like, other than linguistic differences in how you greet elders versus people your own age, in terms of the statements you would make.
Yeah.
Like, so in Ghana, if my uncle came over and asked him to sit, it's a different sentence to if my friend came over and I said, yeah, sit down, take a seat. So, other than that, I'm not really sure. Is it all right if I talk about the whole Dobale situation?
Yeah, please. Go ahead.
I think, again, like, it's a contextual thing. I think Elaine's friends probably didn't tell her because she's not Yoruba. Like, I feel like there's a thing of where you only really expect your cultural greetings from people of the same culture or if marriage is on the cards. So the whole outrage thing, I feel like it's just tied to this thing of where we just look at African practices as backwards, like, automatically. There wouldn't be the same backlash if we're talking about, you know, mutual bowing in some East Asian cultures and traditions.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel if I was a Black British Yoruba person, I'd be a bit annoyed because Yoruba people are always like, people want to talk down on this greeting. They want to, you know, label people Yoruba demons. Like there seems to be like this, people feel freely to disrespect Yoruba traditions and Yoruba people sometimes, and maybe that's me being a bit extra sensitive. I'm not Yoruba myself, but if I'm from as an outsider looking in, I'd be a bit annoyed at that. And on top, I think another thing is that people don't look at the whole practice. So like they only look at the prostrating part for men, but then the elder, correct me if I'm wrong, but the elder's supposed to help you back up.
Yep, that's what they do.
So that's the meat. So it, whereas with a East Asian greeting where they both bow simultaneously, you see that at the same time, like, okay, that's a mutual
respect thing. Whereas people only concentrate on the first part of the Dobale, like, oh, you're on the floor in front of someone that isn't, you know, that, you know, why are you doing that? But they're not looking at the second part, which is that person then helps me up, which then shows that they respect me too. And that's, you know, it's like a circle of respect, circle of love, however you want to describe it. So I feel like when, and this conversation comes up on Twitter every now and then, like every few months. And it's a bit iffy to me. The tones are a bit iffy to me personally, the way I see things. I just think it's one of those things where we inherently put this backwards idea on African practices, which needs to stop. In terms of the skit, the second part, I think that's just maybe like a linguistic thing, in terms of like the way I would say how are you to an elder in my language in Ga is not the same I'd say how are you to a friend of the same age. So I think because English doesn't have that difference, it comes off as disrespect. But again, that's just me interpolating based on what I saw. If I was Yoruba, I'd be a bit annoyed at everyone who is trying to talk on our stuff.
Well, thank you, brother.
I have to agree with you about the greetings as well, because when I was like learning free, there's definitely ways that you can't speak to an elder that you would speak to a peer, and English is, and I'll definitely have to echo what you're saying about English. English is a very simple language, and most other languages have how you refer to plural use, singular use, adults and youngers. And I guess that's why with English is kind of maybe easy in certain respects and not so easy in certain respects for people to learn. And in terms of about the culture, as I said, for me, when it's come to learning to Dobale, literally from being in the ESN Facebook group, didn't even know what the word prostrate meant. Had to go and Google it.
Oh, you wouldn't
but
be doing
we
that.
When I say I speak for myself and I can speak for my tribe, when it comes to the greetings, you enter a room, you go counterclockwise, and you'd start from the right hand side and shake everybody with the right hand.
Yeah. That is what I was.
I've been to a few Ghanaian events where that has been the case.
Yeah. Sorry,
is that in general, or is it for marriage in particular? Because I mostly see that in marriage kind of things.
It would be for everything. So like if we've had a family occasion, say my uncle was to visit my family home, you'd have to come in and you'd greet in the same way my cousins would do exactly the same thing.
Did a woman do the same thing?
Everybody would do the same thing, yeah. Okay. But I don't know if that's because my mum was trying to instill in us that when you go and enter a space, whether it's a wedding, a funeral, a naming ceremony, or big occasions where you don't want to disgrace your family and show you haven't been raised properly, that this is how you show that you go and greet.
Did you say counterclockwise, yeah?
Yes.
Counterclockwise. I've got to agree with Elaine 52 weeks later here. Yep, it is counterclockwise from right to left. It doesn't matter, okay, the stature, okay, of the person, if they're elder or younger. I mean, you'll be more respectful to speaking to elders, but when it comes to greeting into a room, it always has to be right to left. I remember when I was younger, I did it the other way around and got cussed, and like then my parents cussed me as well.
See. Do you know the story behind why it's counterclockwise? Is it just to be consistent
to be against God?
Is it just consistent to be with right hand to left hand, or is it something to do with time or something like that? Because it's just interesting that it's counterclockwise.
I think it's right. I think it's the right hand first.
Right. Okay.
Like they do like they hold like their wrist in it or something.
Which is interesting because Igbo culture is the same. When you go to greet somebody in Igbo culture, if the person's an elder or someone of stature, you have to support your leading hand with your other hand at the elbow.
Mm.
And that is just like that is like an honorific
handshake. I've seen him do this. You see, all right, we are the same. And I've seen him do this, and I've never understood why when I've seen him do that.
You didn't take the time to acknowledge it and ask him.
Shout out Biafra.
Fuck
it. I think also there's the potential of like people's parents not giving them the lowdown on why certain greetings are important. I feel like we as diasporans are often a poor reflection of our counterparts back home because our parents for some reason didn't necessarily give us we'll do the things, but they won't explain this is why you do this or this is why you do this.
Because you're in London now, Nani, and you don't need it. You don't need it in London.
I didn't escape this. This was drilled into me. My cola tradition was drilled into me. the idea that whoever brings cola brings life, the idea that the reason why there's cola and hot drink at the same time is because when you eat, you wee as well, and you poo and you wee. Like, I've been, it's been drilled into me, so I've been fortunate.
Well, there was a time when I was around a elderly person from church, I think it was, and I didn't do it. You know what I mean? And I got, you know, told off in no uncertain ways, a backhand later, and all of that kind of thing. And then I was like, you know, just like our friend, what Nee said, you know, I was like to my mum, you haven't taught me how to do this. This was after. You know what I mean?
So, she beat you again?
No, she didn't. But it's like, you know, what am I supposed to do? Should I have done this? Should I have done that? You know? So I think I must have been about 13. About 13 years old. But this is what I'm saying, is that when our parents come from Nigeria or come from different parts of Africa, sometimes they don't instill certain cultures from back home, and this was one example, let alone my parents not speaking to me in the Yoruba dialect for me to understand it. So from that point onwards, my mum started to show me that you need to do this and you need to do that. But this is just one isolated situation, when I know that there's so many others.
Well, they said that it takes a village to raise a child, and if you was back home and he was doing this, somebody else would have told you a long time ago. Are you mad? You would have been like something. You would have been way. You wouldn't even have been able to get to 13 without somebody acknowledging the fact that you've done something wrong. Can I carry on talking about cultures, but mix it into something?
I don't have any other topics, remember? It's something fun. So you guys,
something are completely a bit different. Like, so yesterday, I went to go on a. It was Easter Sunday, so I was visiting my parents, and I was gonna go home, and then my mum called me to talk to me about something.
Sorry. Just before you continue, can I just refresh the room? Because there's people here that might not know what's going on. They might not know who we are.
Yeah, please, please do. Please do.
All right, for those of you in the Clubhouse room, this is Eloquently Saying Nothing, the podcast. It's a live recording. We're posting this tomorrow, 5 a.m. GMT on all your podcast catches. So catch us there. If you are in the crowd and you want to join us on the stage, Elaine is moderating on our behalf. Is she even there anymore? She's still there. Yeah, Elaine is moderating on our behalf. Make your way up to the stage and you can talk, and if you want to join in the conversation, or if you have any questions that you want to throw at us or anybody else as well. Thank you very much. Carry on.
So we was talking about culture. We ended up talking about culture and the different things about Nigerian culture, which can maybe link to other people's culture as well, and the bad things about our culture that maybe we need to maybe put to the back burner and put to the side. And we were talking about a lot of different things, and one of the situations that came up was domestic violence in the home, and I was talking to my mum and dad quite frankly, because now we're older, you know, I'm a bit older, blah 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 blah, and we were talking about how in Nigerian cultures domestic violence, maybe in the past we would have told people to stay with the person.
So I was
talking to my parents, and we were talking about how there's been in the past some people have in families have had domestic violence.
Not in our home, by the way.
Yeah, not in our home. But in other people's homes and stuff like that. And maybe at some point, some of the elders have been moderators to the situation. And I'm not saying to my parents, like, one of the big problems that we've got with situations like this is that we're so worried about shame to the family, shame to this, shame to that. That instead of doing what may be seen as the right thing, we do what I think is the wrong thing, which is instead of telling people to leave that situation, we're pressurizing them to stay in that situation because you're not supposed to break marriage or you're going to bring shame to the family if you split and all this type of stuff.
Very dangerous.
I wouldn't say that that's a Yoruba.
It's not specific.
I didn't say, but I'm talking from, again, maybe I'm doing a Nana and a Dennis in this situation here, and I'm talking from my point of view of my people. I didn't want to put it on the Ghanaians and this and that before they start telling
me
our people don't do it. But you know what I mean? I'm saying about my, because I don't want anyone to say that I'm offending anyone's family. But I'm just talking about in general with Nigerians. I know that we're very anti-divorce, anti-breakup, anti-this, anti-that, point that if somebody's getting beaten up, whatever, will be the first thing will be like, oh, you know, go back to your husband, you know, so they'll talk about it, they'll moderate, you know, they'll sit down and have discussions, but they're never going to really tell you to leave your husband.
That was every culture before, though.
That's every culture, definitely.
Yeah. I'm not saying it's not. I'm just talking from my own perspective.
Okay,
Saying. They can come and say what they want to say, because I know that it's every culture. But as I said, I didn't want to offend others by saying it's every culture. So I'm going by what I'm saying with mine. So, and another thing that we were talking about is, but that was one of the lead things that we were talking about, how you know, no one's ever telling anybody to leave. And even stuff like domestic violence in the home, even things like how people used to do certain things regarding cutting children and stuff like that to cleanse them and all of these type of stuff. That was a whole big conversation. It was a massive conversation that me and my parents have never really had.
When were you having this?
Yesterday night. I was there till almost 1 a.m. talking about these.
You should have called me.
We was there. But
conference me in, innit?
But we had a big conversation about it. And my mum, I always tease my mum because I buy her two magazines. I buy her That's Life and I buy her
Take a Break.
Yeah. I always tell my mum, why do you read these depressing things that, like, and I always read the headlines like somebody's sleeping with my wife's chicken in the fridge or something like that. It's always some mad headline that they've got in the front or whatever. And my mom said to me, so we were talking about it yesterday, she said, you see, these magazines that you're always talking to me about, until I read these magazines, I didn't know about how many women get killed in their house by their husbands. So it's something she didn't know.
Yeah, yeah.
So she's like, you know, I never thought about all of these things. When people were having domestic violence, I never really thought that the husbands are killing their wives at the rate that they're doing it now. But when I read these magazines, I see it. But this was one of the things that I was saying to my parents yesterday, and they was even agreeing with me that it's something in our cultures, back home cultures, and you know, stuff like that, we need to try and get rid of. We need to start getting rid of this notion that you have to stay together, whatever the problem is, you have to stay together.
Yeah, but you have to make sure that you understand it's relevant to the time. So at the time previously, there was the shame element, but there was also the element that society was set up in such a way where a woman on her own wasn't able to make her way in life reasonably.
I'm not talking about that far back, by the way, bro.
And I'm saying a woman on her own who was previously married, is no longer married, maybe has children or whatever, would not be able to make her life easily. Culturally speaking, a woman that has divorced from a relationship is, again, somebody who would be
tainted.
So there are counterbalances for why people were kind of like very much willing to push the woman back into that situation, because outside of that, now that she's been married, it's very, we do things very publicly, so we make the marriage very public, everybody knows about it. Culturally, these people are married, it's a big thing. For them now to become unmarried or to divorce now becomes another big thing, but there's also a stigma that goes with it. The same way when you get married to a big man as a woman, you become a big woman. If you now get divorced, you now also have a certain stigma that goes with that classification as well. So
when you say big man, what do you mean by big man?
When I say big man, I mean, I don't know, the chief or somebody who's influential within that space or within that circle. We have to take into account that the divorce as well has its own...
Which I completely agree with you. And the thing is, I'm talking about not too far back still. I'm talking maybe this generation still to the generation before.
Yeah, I think...
I'm not pushing it back far.
Yeah,
far.
I know, but I don't think the realities of those previous times may not be the same now.
Yeah.
But the stigma is still the same.
Yes, the stigma is there, which comes with the shame.
We haven't adapted or adapted that shame and stigma element at the same speed as the living conditions have changed.
I completely agree with you. But the thing I was touching on with regards to the whole reason why this even conversation started was because we started with cheating as well. Again, in certain cultures, cheating is seen to be something that is acceptable. Not acceptable, but not divorceable.
Yeah.
Right? And one thing I was saying is that, I don't know, as I said, I would actually like some of the women in the clubhouse group to join to have this discussion at some point. I was saying that how does a woman in these types of situations feel that men, right, or whatever, black men in this particular situation are for them as black women if they are, one, their brothers are not correcting these husbands. Sometimes they even... participating in the cheating themselves, yeah? Right? And how are the fathers now pushing their daughters to go back into situations with men like this? How are you going to be seen to be protecting your women if you're pushing them to go back to husbands that are cheating and pushing them to go back to husbands that might be abusing them? Like, for me, as you lot are fathers of daughters, could you ever see yourself pushing your daughter back to a man that beats them? Or pushing them back to
it's very unlikely.
Or pushing them back to a man that is openly cheating on them constantly? I don't understand how as a woman they would feel when the person that you think are to be as protective towards you, your brothers, your fathers, are not, as far as I'm concerned, doing what I think they should be doing as that type of role.
I hear what you said.
So that's where it stemmed from. But then we went over to the cultures. So what do you think, Webster?
Well,
you got a sister.
I got a sister, yeah. And I would not allow my sister to be in a relationship like that at all. I've often spoke out about certain suitors that she's had and said, I don't like them. Something in my spirit doesn't take to them. And she's always been...
Shout out Derek Jackson.
She's always been open to my opinions, but not very open to taking my opinions.
It's her own life at the end of the day,
yeah, it's her own life. But for me, because she's my elder sister, I'm a younger, she'll probably look at it like, oh, you're young, you don't know what you're talking about. But obviously you as the individual, you will see what you don't like. You will understand what you don't like, but you express it, but it just depends on the way it's taken.
I got in trouble for that in my family, you know.
In what way?
Well, one of my aunts, her partner, I saw him, and you know when your spirit don't take to somebody, and same like Mr. Wolf said the other week, where he could see through Derek Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like you didn't even, that wasn't even in person. That was, you saw him on the internet, but you could just see through him.
Mm-hmm.
You knew that this guy, the foundation wasn't good.
Yes,
the same thing happened with me, but I met the brother. So it's a face-to-face thing, and I'm just like, I could smell it. You know when you could just smell it? I was like,
smell that bullshit from a long way.
And I was like, yeah. So I just put it on him in the middle of the family, like just put it on, like, yeah. So why are you here, innit?
What, in front of everybody?
Yeah, yeah, rags.
That ain't gonna lie.
Yeah, it didn't work. It didn't work. Yeah. So it was like, he quite smartly was like, yeah, but you're one of the youngest people in the room, like. Her dad's here, he's not asking me nothing. Her older brother's here, he's not asking me nothing. And I'm like, I got to give it to him because, like, so why am I going to answer to you? I was like, all right, cool. Yeah. And everybody else was like, oh, why are you being like this with me or whatever? And I said to them, don't worry. There's going to be a time when you lot are all going to come back and say, oh, this man this or this man that or this man this.
Oh, the image face again.
Just to the side.
No, I'm glad you told him that though.
Yeah. I said, you're all going to say it. And then when that happens now, I'm going to be like, yeah, I told you so. And you're going to be like, yo, don't remember.
I don't think you should have said it in front of everyone, though. So as much as there's nothing wrong with his line of questioning, there's nothing wrong with pulling up somebody that you think is suspect when they're around your kin. But I would give the brother and the dad the heads up before I would have had that conversation with him straight. Because that's a front on them as well.
No, but why are they not doing it?
Hmm? They might not see it. If he's more sensitive to that thing than they are. Because not everyone has most mans can see it, but not everyone can see it. And sometimes it's, if you love your sister or your daughter, and you might even be blinded to the fact that she's coming and she's happy, and it's like, because my daughter and my sister is so happy, then that's what makes me happy. Their happiness makes me happy. They've come in, I've raised them well enough, or my sister's smart enough to pick a decent man. And if they come to daddy, brother, this person's decent, and I'm smiling, okay, cool. I'll take your word for it. If you bring a person home, I'm not second guessing the person you're bringing to Allah. It's like, okay, you're smart enough to pick a decent woman.
You would second guess everything in life.
Yeah, but as you lot have noticed in simple situation, he was a younger and he said this to his elder.
Mm.
So he was dismissed as being because he was the younger.
I'm not saying that I'm a bit like Stab, where I might not have said it in front of everyone. The reason, what I'm saying that I'm glad he said to the people is that I think that the older brother and the dad should have had something to say, regardless. Maybe not there, maybe not in front of the family. But if they haven't even taken time to question this man, I'll be skeptical as why you haven't questioned him at all.
So the question was, why are you here? Because I've had that question with family members before. Yeah. But I don't. But the way you said it,
what's your intention?
Which hasn't happened with me before. Yeah. Apart from it, and then even if it has happened with me, it's been on the side with a very firm handshake. But it's this is my cousin. I can speak specifically of somebody that with my wife now, who took me to the side, big person as well, for a Ghanaian. Can you imagine? Man, he towers over me.
Taller than you.
He towers over me. Yeah.
A Ghanaian enigma.
He towers over me, and he shook my hand.
Ghanaian enigma.
As far as I'm concerned, I've done the same thing. He shook my hand very firmly and he's like, so what's, you know, I love my cousin. Yeah, I love my cousin. Like, are you, like, look, man to man, as far as I'm concerned, that is what you should do as a man. But he didn't do it in front of everyone because this was at a function. This is where I met him. I didn't meet him, like, just thinking it wasn't a massive one. Yeah. There was a few people there and he didn't do that in front of everybody. Yeah. So I can respect him as the fact that he took me to the side and he said, well, kind of like, what's your intentions? And I'm like, listen, I like her. We'll see how things go. I didn't lie to him. You know, at the time it was very early and it is what it is. And then now me and this person's cool. You know, I just picked him up from the airport the other day. So that's the relationship we had. If he had done that in front of everyone,
might change things a little bit.
Not for me, because I'm not. That wouldn't bother me personally. But if he had come with the
vigor,
that it seemed like you came with. It's like you came with. He came to me. I think it's like basically I reckon you're all right, but I'm just giving you the warning. I'm a bigger man than you, and if you have a problem with my cousin, I can come here and give you a slap. Mm. I think that was the thing, and I think that's what every person should do to somebody that's dating their sister or their cousin or whatever. I think that's the right of a man to do that to somebody that when you're dating their female relatives. But what you did was, I don't trust you, and I'm pulling you up in front of everybody. And then from there, yeah, the man has to come into the defense mode. And immediately you said that, from when you said that the man, I didn't trust him, and you said that you were going to say something, in my head, straight out of me, I was thinking, this man's going to deflect well. And then when you said that, I was like, I knew it. Because those people are the worst. They're the worst. They're the ones that kind of flex. The ones that probably not going to cheat is the ones that couldn't even hide it if they did it in person. The good cheaters is the lies, isn't it? Or the good, whatever they did. Whether they're doing physical abuse, whether they're cheating, whatever. Those people usually have two faces. And they're quite adept at using the two faces.
Mm, it's true. So what do you think?
What was the original question?
About the conversation that we was having regarding, one, your fathers and brothers maybe not protecting the women the way that they should, and just in general about the culture of pushing marriages to stay rather than...
Not to dismiss what you're saying, but culturally I'm going to take that bit aside, because it's all cultures, I think. And yes, it's different now, but like you said, things have changed in the last maybe 20, 30 years ago. But even if you watch a film or whatever, a British film, an Italian film, or whatever film from 25 years ago, 30 years ago, giving the woman a slap was not a big part of the film. You get me? That was what happened when the person got home and they had a bad day at work. That was normal. So it's not just back home in Africa. It's a standard thing, first of all. So the culturally thing, I'll leave that bit aside. The bit that is interesting is that, this thing about protection. And are we protecting our women if we push them back into relationships with people that are harming them in one way or another? And although things are better now, that would still be a common thing. And I don't know. I guess because marriage is one thing, and then how the person has been in the past is another thing.
Oh yeah, because you're very much of
what am I?
Well, your people can change and all this malarkey, innit?
So no. Well, it depends. People can have a bad situation and it changes them. Yes, but nobody should think everybody stays the same all the time. My big thing is usually that people don't change, but end of the day, somebody can go through some whatever and then change. But if you've been with somebody for 15 years and they've never done anything wrong, they've never stepped out on you, they've never done anything wrong, and then they make one mistake, it's up to you if you want to leave that person or not. I might not be the one. I might not tell you have to leave because they've made one mistake. My thing is now, do you think that's the new person? Has a new person revealed themselves to you? And if they shifted a face, or is it just that something has happened? You got into such a bad argument that day. He had such a bad thing. He drank a drink that he didn't drink. He was eating an edible. He's never done it before. And he lashed out and he did something, whatever that something was that he shouldn't have done. And it's like, do you think he'll do that again? And if it's I don't know or yes or whatever, then maybe it's time to leave. Or you can give people a chance. I don't think, outside of cheating, I don't think I could do anything to my missus for her to leave me immediately after being together. It would be 10 years next month.
So you think that if you was to... So cheating is worse than getting beaten up?
Yeah.
In her eyes?
Probably.
Oh, wow. See, and that's a mad thing. That's a mad...
Probably.
In my brain, that's mad.
Because anybody can hit anybody. You've hit me before.
You rightly deserve it.
So my point is, as much as you don't like the idea of being in a relationship and hitting somebody, you've hit your own brother.
Yeah, but I wouldn't... I hit a girl.
Yeah, but all right, me and you have different views on that. So the thing is... The effect is you can hit somebody you love and hit them even because you love them. You can't cheat on somebody you love because you love them.
What? You can't cheat on somebody you love because you love them?
You don't
cheat. That's not true, Steph.
Go on then, explain to me how I'm wrong.
Why? Because it depends on the reasons why you are cheating on somebody. There have been many times in history where you've seen someone has been cheated on, and once they've been discovered that they have cheated, they will cry, they will beg the person they've cheated on and say, I didn't mean to do that, I didn't mean to hurt you, I didn't mean to do any of that kind of jazz. And the only reason why I think that they are apologising is because they were caught.
I don't think you're saying what you're saying.
Let him finish, sorry. Go on.
I'm gonna have to duck out soon as well because I've got a room in 5 minutes. But I'm saying that you can cheat on somebody and still claim to love them or love them, because the reason why you're cheating might not be because of the fact you've fallen out of love with them.
Yeah, that's Wahala's right. That's not what I said. I said I can hit you because I love you.
Yeah,
I can't cheat on you because I love you.
Well, you can, but
you can cheat because why? How are you cheating? Okay, because so, I love you.
Because
I don't understand.
You can use that as an excuse.
It could be a case of I love you so much.
Yes,
I love you. All this love and my love is uncontrollable. And I don't know.
Pom-pom the turn up.
You made me feel like you hated me.
No, I love you, but I just had sex with
her. No. You made me feel like I hated me. You made me feel sort of way. And now I've cheated on you because I wanted to get back at you. But I loved you. That's why I did it. If I didn't love you, I wouldn't have cared enough that the fact that you made me feel a way to make me go and cheat with another person.
That sounds like Jada Pinkett.
That sounds the same way as a beating.
But there's so many different excuses.
The same thing as you got me so angry that I hit you. You got me so angry that I cheated.
I disagree.
But then people can cheat and say it doesn't mean I love you any less. It just means I wanted to have sex with somebody else.
That is true.
I think there's a misconception about like cheating being directly linked to whether or not you like the person or you love the person.
You can love somebody and cheat on them. That's
exactly
taken into account. That's not what I said.
I know that's what you said. You said that you can't cheat. You can't cheat on someone because you love them. And I'm saying if you hit somebody because you love them so much, you can cheat on someone because you love them so much. Right, it sounds stupid, but it's probably the case.
What about our other listeners in Clubhouse? What do they think? Are they still there? Are they still available to speak?
The D and D are on the stage, and as I said, I'm going to have to step out for 3 minutes.
No problem. When you need to leave, just go. I'll take it from there.
All right, D Brave here. If okay, you can't have sex with your partner, and you're feeling kind of like depressed, kind of thing. Could there be an argument to say, okay, that you're cheating because you don't want to be depressed and then actually take that out on your partner because you love them so much?
I thought the argument was going to come that basically because you don't want to leave your partner because you love them so much, you cheat on them for whatever reason, you can't do something with them. So you cheat on them because you can't do something with them, but you love them. That's why you stay. I thought that was going to be the argument that came. I hear your one, 52 weeks. And for me, no, you're just cheating, isn't it? You're just cheating. That's it. You love your partner and you're cheating on them and you're not leaving them because you love them. You're not cheating on them because you love them.
What do you think about
love and sex are two different things.
Exactly. So
what Dee just said was he couldn't have sex with his partner for whatever reason.
Then
so he decided to go and have sex somewhere else because he was depressed.
That's his business to be depressed, isn't it?
So maybe I need some clarification then. How do you then get to a stage where you can beat somebody because you love them then? How are you justifying that?
This is it.
So if I beat my partner because I'm depressed, does that count?
I think I know what he's going to say, but I was kind of confused on that as well.
Sorry?
Go on.
I think that you're utilising the other person. You're using an excuse and blaming them, but it's got nothing to do with them. It's all about the person. So if you you can love somebody and you can cheat on them, but it's not that you're cheating on them because you love them. In the same way that you can think you love somebody and you will beat them, you can't say that I'm beating you because I love you.
I'm confused at how
I can.
Okay, explain that to me. Sorry, Nana, to cut you. I want him to explain this because I'm confused about it.
And then I want to go back to the original topic as well.
Go on. Okay, I'll give you an example. Maybe you guys might rubbish it because it's like it's different, but just try and move your head in that direction. You have a child. You have a child.
I knew you were coming this way.
Yeah, because
go on.
You might smack your child is not because I hate you. It's because I'm trying to school you or I'm trying to teach you. Obviously, your wife or your husband is not your child. No, but just go with me. But you would never, I would hope, you would never up and leave your child and pick up another child and say, I'm leaving you now and I've got this other child. Because you can't do that from love. It's like, you can love the other child, but what has that got to do with your own child?
But what kind of scenario can you with reference to your spouse?
About him hitting him?
Yeah, because with the child.
Some people would say that it is not right to smack your child, right? So that argument there, and most people, 99% of people, well, majority of people would say it's not right to hit your partner, right?
Yeah.
So it's the same thing.
No, it's not.
I could argue that it is right for me to hit my child.
Yeah.
You can't, and we can have that argument. You can't argue, well, you could argue with me that I'm not hitting my child because I love them. you're not hitting your child.
But what
out of love.
An example have you got? In yes, a spousal example that you can say that you're beating this woman and it's out of love.
Okay. All right, fine. But
is it she on a ventilator and you want to beat her heart to start it beating or something?
Before I go down that road, because you asked me that question a second, do you understand what I'm saying? And does that make sense? Because if it makes sense to you, then you don't need to then start asking me all that stuff.
Yes, you do.
No, not necessarily.
I'm looking for an example.
No, so what you said makes sense to me. And the reason why it makes sense to me is because you are dealing in a relationship where there is one, where there's insight. There's clearly one person who has a greater insight than the other person because of the other person only being XYZ age. They haven't had any experience in certain things at all. So the justification comes with insight. Now, I'm not saying that it's definitely right to beat the child or not, but you can understand, moreover, where the justification for that beating can come from.
Mm.
In a spousal situation, unless you're dealing with an underage person or you're dealing with somebody who is tremendously younger than you, the same argument can't be applied.
But you're bringing that into the equation when I'm saying that the reason you smack the child, saying the reason you smack the child is because they're young. I'm saying the reason you smack them is because you love them.
This is one long big circle, man. Give an example of when you meet a woman that is out of love, I beg. And if you can't give one, let's say I can't give one. I will accept it this time.
Because they're cheating on you.
You think that's out of love? That's not out of love, that's out of anger.
That's out of anger.
Yeah, but if...
Sorry, well, you want to say something?
I think that's 52 weeks.
Oh, okay.
I don't think so, you know, because everybody's mute, so I don't...
No, do you know, it was me, okay? That's not out of love.
He's not on the stage.
Because they betrayed you. That's not out of... You're not beating them out of love.
It's out of anger.
It's out of anger.
It's out of anger.
It's out of something else. It's not love.
Okay. Jealousy, anger, disrespect.
Yes, jealousy. How can I put it?
Talking about jealousy.
That's not a good example. If you can think of another one.
I think we should just leave it.
Yeah, all right, fine. I can't think of a better example. Because I can actually say that, yes, you hit somebody because you're angry. Same way you might hit your child because you're angry. But you keep bringing things into the equation instead of whether you like it or... Because this is the thing. The difference between whether you like it or you don't like it is different from whether it makes sense or it doesn't make sense. So if I love you and you cheat on me and I hit you, it's different from if I don't care about you at all and you cheat on me and then I just walk out of the room.
The same way that I'm saying then if you cheated on me and I'm angry at you so I have a revenge cheat, I'm doing it because I love you.
So you're trying to say love is painful and these are all the expressions of the painful side of love.
Well, Jaru did say pain is love.
So also I'm gonna murder. Love is murder.
I'm gonna say the court of public committee says rejected.
Okay then. You know what? I will back down on the argument. I didn't think through it clearly, and because I don't have the right tools and ammunition to back it up, let me just relinquish that one.
Okay, so go back to the original questions about the actual thing that it stems from, which was the protecting your sibling or your daughter in these types of situations where people are pushing them back. And I'd like to hear from you as well, Mr. Wolf.
I don't know, man. I think I answered it before I said kind of.
Okay, then. Mr. Wolf, what are you saying?
One question again, please.
So, I was talking to my parents about how, you know, people back in the day and even still now are pushing their family members to go back to husbands that are beating them or pushing their siblings to stay with men that are cheating with them because it's the done thing. And do you think that this is having a negative effect on how maybe black women are viewing the men in their household who's pushing them to go and stay with the cheater or to go and stay with the woman beater who's not, you know, going out of their way to rectify the situation? Because a lot of things that us as black men like to go on, like we're hard and we're heavy and we're always protecting our sisters and yada, yada, yada. But there's a whole heap of us that's pushing them back to the cheating husband and pushing them back to the beating husband as well.
How do I feel about that?
Yeah, what do you think about that? What do you think of those types of situations? That's what I said.
I think it's obvious, isn't it? Really, it's not ideal. It's not a good situation. Without a doubt, it has happened in our cultures and many other cultures. You know what I mean? If put myself into that situation, obviously I'm going to speak out now as a grown man and an adult. Me as a younger boy, perhaps I may feel a sense of fear. I may feel like I might be disrespecting maybe an older sister or older cousin or what have you, you know. And there are some men who are not confrontational, so they may be grown men and they may fear the confrontation that may come, not only from the man, but also from the person that they love. You understand? So they may, you know, from the outside looking in, you know, they can see that abuse has taken place. Someone has cheated on this individual. We've heard so many different stories of even women going to their girlfriends saying that your man has cheated and the woman has gone, you know, hard on their supposed friend. You get me? As opposed to thank you for the information, and I'm going to deal with it. So it's obviously a wrong thing, you know. It's not nice and it's not ideal, but I think the person that I am now is completely different to the person that I was when I was 15, 16, 17, so 18.
You got older sister. Mm. In fact, you got a younger sister and an older sister. Mm-hmm. But let's start with the older one. So she married?
No.
So let's say she gets married.
I'm not talking about.
Man, just remove the marriage in that.
No, because I got the two mixed up, bro.
The older sister's married, yeah? And obviously, you know the husband. Let's say you've got a good relationship with the husband. I don't know. But let's say that you do in respect, whatever. If something happened that you found out, let's say you went to your mum's house and God forbid your mum told you something bad happens between the husband and the wife, yeah? Uh-huh. Would you insert yourself into that marriage and have and get involved in that situation? Or would you say that's their marriage?
No, I mean, my family know me. So I'm I don't mince my words. And I'm not scared to say what needs to be said at the time that it needs to be said. I think that there's some moments where filters required and there's some moments where you need to be upfront and blatant about it. And sometimes people are, that you know, people want to skirt around certain situations. They want to beat around the bush, mm-hmm. so to speak. And sometimes going right direct to the point, right in the bone marrow and getting that information or, you know, speaking your mind about something so somebody can hear it firsthand from someone who they know cares for them and someone who they know loves them. And that's the kind of person that I am. So if I am in that situation now, I know what I would do. You know what I mean? You know, I know what I would do. I know what I would say to my sister and I know what I would say to her husband.
So you wouldn't say yourself in
without a shadow of a doubt. I would. I mean, I think that we as men, I even teach my son now. You know what I mean? It's like, we at times have to sacrifice ourselves, you know, to protect our women. You get me? It's like my son is the oldest out of the two. And I know that I would die to protect my kids, my mom, even my family, you know. And he is the young man of the house, so to speak. And I've told him that there may be a time when you need to protect your mom. There may be a time when you need to protect your sister. And in doing so, you may put yourself in harm's way.
That's a lot of pressure for us.
It is. You know, he's 17. He's 17. But the thing is that I was never taught these kind of things. And sometimes people have that default mechanism in them anyway.
Mm.
You get me? Like there's some people who are confrontational, who are happy and they have no problem in being in that situation. And there's other people who may need to pluck up the courage to put themselves in that position. You understand?
And do things differently.
Yeah, you get me. So, you know, just going back a little bit in terms of the situation with my sister and her husband, being who I am, I would have no issues inserting myself. And I think it would be the right thing to do, bearing in mind that this is her relationship, innit?
Mm.
So I would feel a way if I don't say anything.
Okay.
You get me? So I know that regardless of what I say, perhaps there is a chance that it's going to go in one ear and it's going to come out the other. But my point is that I have to do and I have to say something. Whether she's going to take that on board or not is another thing.
All right. So Stav.
Is anyone still on the... Because I actually want to hear from a woman on this topic.
Okay, sorry. There. Yeah, go ahead.
They'll go. No, there's no women.
There's no woman on stage, but I want to say something 52 weeks later.
Talk to me.
Go on, brother.
That's pretty much what you guys have already said, okay, that I would step in. I feel okay that our parents, grandparents, and possibly even this generation right here, we're told, okay, about all the virtues of marriage and such, and it's of like attaining that level, that status of marriage, but we're not told, okay, about how to work a marriage, how to keep a marriage, how you're supposed to function mm-hmm. in a marriage.
Yeah, mm-hmm. for real.
It's kind of like get married, and then you do your own thing. You do your own thing. Don't involve us. Keep it in-house and such. I really feel that we need to break away, okay, from that framework because it's not working. And I can understand, okay, black women feeling unprotected. If they've encountered either cheating or abuse, and then the people, their family, okay, that they're looking up to, okay, especially, okay, their brothers and fathers are saying, oh, you must work through it. We don't need a shame and such. This is not just okay for the black culture as well, because spending time in Japan, I found that fathers, Japanese fathers, they would okay actually turn a blind eye okay to their daughter being cheated on, even okay suggesting okay to their son-in-laws to visit women of the night.
Wow. Yes.
They send them to the house.
Yes.
Yep.
yes.
Sorry.
As long as they keep the marriage
woman of the
intact,
night,
you know. Well, the view AKA of the marriage
Pashmina
intact.
Workers.
Yes. Yes.
And I think Nee mentioned before, okay, about East Asia, about when they like bow, they bow at the same level.
Mm.
That's not strictly true.
That's right.
There's different levels to it. So to a foreigner, you might just see a bow, okay, as you're both bowing at the same level.
Yep.
But those that are lower levels in life will bow a lot deeper, lower than yep. the people on the higher echelons.
Yep, yep.
Boy, you're so, fat
so,
issue, boy.
So, Dee, you said that this thing about getting married is people took up the virtues, but they don't push the realisms, the negatives, and the actual day to day ins and outs.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of advice would you give towards that then? Because I'm not sure what I'd give. Because if it should be relatively easy. It shouldn't be too hard.
No, well, marriage is supposed to be difficult. So anyway, go on.
It's supposed to be, you know.
It is supposed to be. Go on, brave.
Well, I would say, okay, that if you recognize, okay, that you're coming together as one, but you are still two individuals.
Yeah.
And what brought you together is kind of like an alignment kind of thing when the stars aligned. But as you grow, you might grow apart. The thinking might change at a different pace. I mean, you would hope, okay, that it would, okay, stay together. But if it doesn't, then don't feel afraid to get outside consultation.
How? Talk to people outside and embarrass the name.
Exactly. This would be either you're going to a counselor or get somebody, okay, that you both, okay, respect independently and to like try and hash out the issue if you've got problems. If, okay, somebody has actually stepped out, then that gets a bit serious. It gets a bit harder, okay, also, okay, to get somebody that's independent that you know. So you might have to go for a counselor and such. But, I'd say, okay, that marriage is not easy, that you need to work on it, such as everything in life. That's my advice I'd give them.
Thank you. Simple. Why is married life meant to be hard?
Well, when I say meant to be hard, I mean, it's not like you made it out just now, just by reference. Oh, no, I don't know what I would give an advice because it's easy. Just the dynamics of it alone means that it's not supposed to be easy. You've got two completely different people,
yeah,
depending on when they've met, at what time of their life, they've had two completely different upbringings.
Yeah.
If they are marrying outside of their cultures, they've got two completely different cultures. You now need to mesh all of these ideas together in such a way that you have some kind of unified harmony amongst you. And then you also then, if so be it, the next stage is that you bring another human being into the world, and then that human being has to now embody the combined cultural teachings and understandings of both of your individual sides, plus this new understanding that you've created between the two of you, that is the bit in between that forms or maintains your relationship, they now need to understand those and then also become their own person as well. So for me, the number of moving parts would suggest that probability wise, there is a certain amount of work and effort to do. It's like having a garden. It's not hard to mow grass, but you have to keep doing it over and over and over again. You've got to tend to it. So to say that it's an easy thing and there's no work to be done there, I would say is a little bit disingenuous.
All right. Like I said, I don't have the topic, so if you guys could help me out and one of you do something, please.
Yeah, topic-wise, you had a thing, you put a thing in about Pimlico Academy, this Afro and hijab student process.
You guys know about that?
No, I don't know nothing about it, boy.
I've heard about it, but go ahead.
So a school in Pimlico, which is an affluent borough in South London.
South.
Not far from Victoria.
It's not a borough, is it?
Sorry.
It's a town.
Is it a town?
It ends.
It doesn't matter.
Go on anyway. Continue, go on.
But it's not a borough, sorry. Pimlico, it might be, it's in Victoria then. I can't remember, but it's in...
It's just up the road, just saying, man. Bloody hell.
Because he's confusing himself now because he's trying to rectify
it. He's not confused.
No.
Okay.
You'd like to interrupt me with that.
An area in South London.
Right? Yes. No, it's fine. It's just... I have to try and even remember the thing and it's like... You're wrong. Yes, there was a school in Pimlico where the head teacher said he didn't want people having afros or colourful hijabs. So this was now banned from the school. And on the last day of term, which has just happened this week, they took a sit-in. So they didn't go into class. They all came to school and then decided to sit outside or to stand outside in the playground and to protest this change of rules because they found it to be racist, basically. And then they changed the rule. And on top of that, there was a British flag that they had recently put in the ground somewhere outside, I believe, flying outside. And they took offense to the British flag and they took that down as well. So what would you say? And this is stems from, or it's related to something that we spoke about maybe a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, where there was a rule that girls couldn't wear shorts in a certain school somewhere.
Yeah, I remember that.
And the boys wore skirts to... Sorry, girls couldn't wear shorts.
Yeah.
That is what I said, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. So boys went in with shorts to protest the girls not being able to wear shorts because there's no rule, obviously, for boys to wear shorts.
Mm.
What would you feel like with... Well, I guess it's two-tier. One, do you agree with the rule, which I'm assuming we don't? Two is this thing about the British flag, because they said basically it's almost like it's a racist thing. There's no black in the flag kind of thing, so it shouldn't be there. I don't get it. You live in Britain, so they can have a British flag on the thing. So that's one thing there, but I'd like to hear you guys' views. Maybe you think differently than me. And then a big thing is, would you be happy if your child went to school and they started protesting? I'm not going to talk about this. It's something that you actually disagree with. You can see their passion and what it is, but they're saying, I'm not going into class because I'm protesting X, Y, and Z. Would you want your child to be taking up this thing? This is a secondary school, by the way. So they're between 11 and 16, these children. Thank you very much.
So first one, I'm going to answer is about the flags. This flag thing is fascinating for me because I kind of understand it from two points of view. I understand where people are coming from, where they're saying the racism or what have you, because of what the flag has stood for previously in the past. But I also understand from the other side, my Jamaican side particularly. If you go to Jamaica, everybody has a flag. And when I say everybody, you will not see a car that drives past without the Jamaican flag in there. It's flying always. People will have the flag in the car. People will have personal effects that will have the flag on it. Like patriotism to the flag in Jamaica is a big thing. So you see that flag all over the place. They don't have obviously the legacy of slavery with the flag going to go and take over people's land and all those kind of stuff. So the stigma towards the flag isn't the same, but the patriotic behavior of having the flag and having it visible almost at all times still remains. So when I see that with this British Union Jack thing, part of me is like, yeah, I mean, they're proud of their country, innit? Like, I know their country's done a lot of fucking, but they're proud of it. It's kind of like, you know, you got a family member that you know, did some fuckery in the past and they've turned around and then they've done better now and they're still a fucked up person, but you're kind of proud of them because you've seen the progress that they've made. So the person's not perfect, but you still have a certain level of pride in them. Same with the country. The country's not perfect, but they've got a level of pride in it, especially with their, as being indigenous people. So with that, I'm a bit on the flag thing. People being upset by the flag being flown all over the place because of what it means historically, I get it. But at the same time, they're also not looking at the fact that people are allowed to be proud of their country.
You're only allowed to be patriotic as a British person when there's some form of sport involved.
Yeah, which is mad to me, as far as I'm concerned.
Even politicians are getting it now for having it in the background when they're doing their Zoom calls and some of those things.
But again, with them politicians, with them having it in the background and all that, that's very deliberate. And it's, when I say deliberate in the sense where
people call it dog whistling and stuff.
Yeah, they're kind of, it, for me, I don't think it is genuine that they're doing that. I think they're doing it particularly to antagonize people. I think so.
Do you feel antagonized when you see a British flag?
I don't, but there are clearly people that are antagonized by it.
But why would you want to antagonize people in it? Would you want to galvanize people with it?
It depends. It depends on what their motive is. That's the only thing with these lot. You can't tell with the motive.
I would actually say that if you're going down the road that this person is racist and they're trying to, like, you know, then it's probably more towards galvanizing my people. Vote for me because this is what I believe in, as opposed to I'm trying to
distance myself from others.
Yeah, so piss like people off.
Nick Farage. Yeah, if he's got
which one is Nick
Ferrari? Now if he's got a flag up there, he used to be UKIP or whatever it was. If he's got a flag up there,
Nick Ferrari, isn't he the radio?
Yeah,
not Nick Ferrari is the radio presenter.
Nigel Farage.
Sorry, that's the one. Sorry, Nigel Farage. They're all the same to me. Nigel Farage.
Wow.
If he had a flag up there, you would say that he's probably inciting a thing.
No, I would say that it was galvanizing these people then.
Hold on, which flag are we talking about? The Union Jack or the George Cross flag?
They're all the same to me.
The Union Jack, yeah, it's the same.
No, because one of them holds more.
One of them holds more clout, isn't
it? Which one? England. The Union, the George's Cross is England, isn't
it? Yeah. That's the one that I would say maybe might be more.
Knights of the Round Table, Templars, and all that kind of
thing. More of a beef thing than the UK one.
Ain't that the British version of the Confederate flag?
No.
No, but yes.
In a way.
Yeah. But no.
But no.
But they won.
No, but no.
They won.
But we won.
Yeah.
It's no. But the thing is, because they didn't just colonize everywhere else, they colonized their neighbors too. So that's really like even though we colonize you, and now we have one unified flag because we're all together.
We still fly this
I'm
one.
Still doing my own one. Like,
yeah, Wales got their own flag. Scotland's
yeah, but
got their
they
own
were
flag.
Colonized, so it's like you can have, your flag was there before this. Like, so if you were to keep
yeah,
the
St. George's flag was there before this as well. It's just that they made this Union Jack so everyone can feel happy.
When you're the winner,
hence the Union.
Yeah, when you're the winner and you've beaten people, there's sometimes a humble approach you have to take.
There's a humility about it,
which is what I'm saying. That's the Union Jack.
It's like Germany lost the World War or whatever, but their humility take was that they don't have an army now as a result of that. Yeah, they actually won the war technically speaking because they now are in a position where they don't have an army, but they're also the strongest force in Europe.
Are you sure the German people don't have an army?
They don't have an official.
Have you seen Hydra?
They officially don't have an army.
Hell, Hydra.
I think that's even Russian as well. But anyway.
So you've spoken on the flag.
Yeah, the flag one. And then what's the other one?
Would you be happy with your child going protesting school, missing out on classes for a cause that they believed in, but you didn't?
Ooh. Now, because of how I understand what protest is, I know that I don't have to agree with it in order for it to be the correct action to take. So on this one, as long as I could ascertain that my child actually knows what they're doing, they actually know what it is they're fighting for, even if I don't agree with
it. The right to wear skinny jeans.
Yeah, it's a bit, as I'm saying to you, the subject matter has to be of substance. And it's not substance necessarily to me, but like I need to understand the principle that they're standing on. I don't have to agree with
it. They are going because they want the changing rooms and the toilets to be all gendered.
Why don't you just use the one that they've actually going for?
Because I just think
as far as I'm concerned, all of us at this table believe that we would want our children to take part in that protest. So let's make it a bit harder, where it's like there's something that they believe in. You can see what they're doing it for, but you don't actually like. Let's not say you don't believe in it, but you have no. You don't even care either which way.
But your child could potentially get expelled because of it.
Maybe get expelled. Start maybe slacking on scores. It's like it's too. So now the cause is not as important as what your child's grades or your child being in that school. Maybe you actually you might like the school, and so you don't even you might not even disagree with what the school is saying. But your child, but then you have a part of you that says, I want my child to, well, maybe, I don't know, some people might be different. They might not want their child to kick up a fuss or to ever do that thing anyways.
No, but I feel like it's important for young minds to understand the power of protest. And I think if we come in from an early age like that and we kind of douse and don't show the power of protest to the young minds like that, they then grow up later on with no mechanism for fighting against iniquities and all those kind of stuff. So I feel like it's important that you kind of find a way to, like, if I don't agree with it, my thing is this: I'll show you the consequences or the potential consequences of your actions based on what's going to happen or what will potentially happen, but you need to have a crystal clear understanding of what it is you're protesting for, what it is protest is as a tool and mechanism, and also you have to be able to live with the consequences that are going to come afterwards. But I'm not going to stop that person from doing a protest. I think it's very important that young people understand what a protest is, the power of a protest, and they should be able to have a lived experience of that so that when they get older, they don't turn into what's happened to a lot of our generations where there is no fight because it's like, yeah, what's the point?
Webs?
I kind of agree with Simple. As long as your child knows what they're doing and understands the ramifications as well, because it could go either way in that respect. So the school might just say, okay, young Johnny is one of those kids that incite violence, incite protest, incite this, that, and the other for their own gain without knowing what their gain is, just to be popular or just to do this, that, and the other. And if they don't have an understanding of it, then it doesn't work in their favor. So I think to have an understanding would be an ideal thing as that child.
Oof.
I agree with the other guys, man. I don't think that there's any more that I need to add, to be honest. It is what it is.
People need to understand that Jesus protested, you know. When he turned over the table with the money on the outside of the church, that was protest right there, blood.
Yeah, it's like protest, you know me, and sheep, you know, and the way how I kind of feel what the masses are at the moment. We get told to do something and we just do it without even a thought process. And, you know, those who may question the idea of something are looked at in a particular way. So Simple is correct. The kids have to understand and know the importance of protest, even at a minor level. And even if it is something that I deem to be something quite minor or something that I don't particularly agree with, if their heart is in the right place, then I will back my child 100%.
Exactly. If you're bringing your child up to be an individual, have their own mind, have their own thought process, then that's fine. You can't expect your child to be just follow you, follow them, follow those. Be your own leader.
All right. Anybody in the clubhouse room, if you want to come to the stage, is by all means, raise your hand. D is now moderator, so you can bring you up there. D, if you wanted to add your own 2 pence into this before Wahala and move on to the next topic, by all means as well. Also, if any of you got another question that you want to add, we'll be winding down to an end soon. So if you've got something else that you wanted to bring to the conversation, now's your chance. Raise your hand, come to the stage and do your thing. So D, if you wanted to talk, and then Wahala.
Yeah, so I think you put 3 questions there. So the first one, I think the school was totally wrong, okay, with the initial thing that they had. Second question about the flag. It's a shame, okay, but the British flag and the St. George's Cross, it was hijacked by the far right. Because I know, okay, like when my parents like came to the country, like their generation, okay, they were okay with that, the flags and the flying of the flags. I remember like going down to St. Trafalgar Square and St. George's Day. And there was no issue, okay, with seeing the flags about and such. So, yeah, it's a shame, okay, that the far right kind of hijacked, okay, the flag as a symbol. But I can understand people being upset having the Union Jack torn down or even burned. I think it might have been burned because it is this country's flag. I know, okay, if I was living back in Ghana and people took down the Ghana flag and burnt it, I'd be upset as well. So, yeah, I can understand, okay, people being upset with the flag being taken down, and I wouldn't support that action.
How many percentage of Ghanaians do you think would have been upset with the fact that the flag got burnt in Ghana?
I don't know. I can only speak for myself.
I knew you were too smart to go for that one. Here we keep going.
And then for the final thing, question about if your kid was protesting and it was something that you didn't agree with. I think that's a very good question. Because if I agreed with it, then I'd be all for it. But if I didn't agree with it and I felt, okay, it was damaging them, I would acknowledge, okay, that they're protesting and that's a good thing. But since I don't agree with it myself, I'll be trying to get that locked down. I'd tell them, okay, that they will face consequences by protesting. And why are you living in my house? You ain't going to protest that particular subject or topic.
Seriously, you'd really go as far as that?
He's not one of these freedom fighters like you.
I'm with him.
I would, because, as I said, if it's something, okay, that I agree with or I don't really care about, that's fine. But if it goes against like my actual kind of like morals and such, I can't advocate my child to go against what my morals are.
I think I'm even more than him. I don't care if I agree with it or not.
I kind of get it. And this is why I said, like, if your heart is in the right place, and I understand why some parents may not be interested or, you know, just listen, you do the right thing and that's it. But sometimes you need to give your children rope, not to hang themselves, but to learn. You understand what I'm saying?
Quick question, okay? If your child was protesting the right to call you by your first name, mm-hmm. would you still be okay with him protesting that?
And this is maybe the term, the heart in the right place is not the correct term. I think it's the morals. If I may disagree with something that they are protesting on, or disagree with anybody on something, but if they're morally in a correct space and where maybe disrespect isn't part of the agenda.
Morals is subjective, though. That's the point. It's the morals to you. It's about to be morals to somebody else.
I get that, but, you know, I'm happy with disagreeing with something that somebody else is protesting with, and even my child. Like, I would not come down with an iron fist on them.
You take into account some the repercussions, potentially, not definitely, but potentially could be being either suspended from school for a certain amount of time or missing out on classes.
I think Simple Simon kind of highlighted the idea that you kind of iron out in the most simplistic terms of what could happen if you continue to do what you're doing. You understand what I'm saying? So that's me personally. I mean, we're here as parents to guide our children, and when they make mistakes, you're there to assist them and to help them learn from their mistakes. So that's me. I mean, if you are protesting on something that is a part of a school, is that cause to get expelled? I think it all depends on, and this is what I'm saying, I think it all depends on what the what they're protesting for, and then it depends on their behavior. Yeah. And this is what I'm saying, that you iron out the consequences for your actions, and you tell them what is right and what is wrong. And, you know, I think that if I see my child and they're protesting and they're deciding to break windows and to do all that kind of foolishness, then I'm thinking, like, you know,
I'm not talking about damaging property or doing all that stuff.
Well, there you go.
But there's some private schools where written down in that thing will be like, you can't do this. We'll just X you out. And ticketing is going, you would have paid all that money as well.
And some of these schools are saying that you can't cut your hair a certain way, innit? So what you've done is that you specifically put something in there that you know that you won't agree with, innit? And I get that. But in realities, that's not really a real scenario, innit? I personally think, personally, on a personal level, that most of the things that my son or my daughter, even at the age that she's at, their moral compass is kind of in the correct place. They know the right things to do and the wrong things to do. They would know what is a right thing to protest and what is or what just doesn't make sense. So with a subject matter that I don't agree with, would I back them? I think I would, but I don't think it's going to be something that is going to be so outlandish that is going to get them in hot water.
I think in my situation, I'm telling them not to protest, whether or not I agree with them or not.
Why not?
Because they've got the notion that they could be expelled. I'm going by your original thing that it could be a potential expulsion and suspension.
Yeah.
I would tell them to tell me what the problem is, and if I agree with it, I will go and I will make my own protest regarding that situation.
But don't you think, like Simple said that, and Mr. Wolf are saying that it encourages a seed of
no.
I think
if they came to tell me and I want to go and deal with them, or I want to go and take their protest on hand for them, I think it'll show that I believe in them and I believe that what you're saying is right. Well, I don't want you to be expelled. Because as far as I'm concerned, your future is more important than anything else to me.
But then most protests, it's like you take a risk when you're doing it.
Yeah, I don't want you to take risks. I want you to get your education and I want you to get to a point where I want you to do what I want you to do.
See, here's the thing now. I want my child to learn to take risks. That's like that. Because
well and good for you.
Because I'm not going to be there forever.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm not saying that I don't want my child to understand. I'm not saying that me and my child can have a conversation about what it is, but if I'm sending you to a certain particular place and I want you to get to a certain level and I want you to be, and I want the best for you, right? Then I have to make the sacrifices. What you guys were talking about sacrificing. So if anyone's going to go there and protest or anyone's going to go there and make all this noise, it's going to be me, because you need to go and get your education and you need to come out of that place. You are my most important thing, not somebody else that you're protesting for. I understand that you got your people that's there. And all your friends and whatever, and these things is a bad thing towards them, and I don't like it, so I will join you in maybe even rallying up over some of the other parents and going there myself and protesting outside with the parents if I can do it. But you're going to go and get your education, and you're going to come out with what you need to come out with.
It's interesting. And just to count on something you said, Mr. Wolf, you know, we're looking to move, and my missus was looking at schools, because obviously you want to move to an area with good schools, and she saw one girl's school. It was a private school where the pass rate for A to, I think it was A star. So A's and A stars was 99.6%. Yeah. GCSEs.
Mm.
Like, I couldn't even believe it was true. I thought, like, that's a madness.
Five students there.
I can't even, we realized, but it must be like one student that got a B or a C. And then everyone's looking at them like, come on, man, you messed up, man. So the classes must be tiny or whatever. And then when we found out how much it cost, it was like nearly 50 grand a year, 47,000 pounds a year.
A whole salary a year. Wow.
47 pounds.
Yeah, well, then you'd expect that pass.
So
rate,
then it's like, yeah. I'm going to assume,
yeah, definitely,
in that contract there, then, like, forget even the school. As a parent, if you're paying that much and they're like, if your child misses blah, 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 we're sending them out. Imagine they've done 4 years of that, 3 years. You've spent 40 grand for 3 years and then they're protesting something and they might get kicked out. Hey, like, this is all this money I've pumped into it.
Well, you want to try to take risk?
Yeah, but again,
that's not risking your money.
That's the other risk. So and you also, you have to take into account, is that what you don't want to do is allow good principle to be overwrought with money. Like, you shouldn't allow money to get in the way of good principle. So yeah, you paid 50 grand a year. Yes, it's a big money. But if the principle of what they're fighting for is one that stands up to tests, then 50 grand or not, you have to ride it out.
No, I'll fight for you. You go to school. Do you want to get to the last topic? Because it is actually quite thingy about this. It's to do with the You're shaking your head, so I don't know. You're just shaking your head like a monkey. I don't know what that means. This thing about the racial equality or whatever behavior. You're the one that posted it in the group in the first place. What happened? They said Britain is not racist or whatever.
Institutional racism report.
That's the one. I don't actually care about it, to be honest, but it was in there and it's topical. So whether people want to speak about it or not.
Man say you don't care after he just called his brethren a monkey. Anyway, go on.
I can say it. I'm even going to buy him the H&M t-shirt.
Yeah, Mr. Wolf, go on. Introduce that. It was your subject. You even put two things in there for it.
He looks like he's trying to escape.
A man don't know what is.
I am trying to escape. I've got to go. But yeah, I'll just touch on it quickly. I mean, I think it's there for everybody to see.
Yeah, but everybody...
Hold on.
Yeah, so you're like, UK no longer a country where system is deliberately rigged against ethnic minorities, race review says. Yeah?
There was a race review put on by the British government after the George Floyd protests in this country to find out where racism is at in this country. There was a selection of intellectuals and whatever that they had headed it up. There was one white person, I believe, three blacks, two Asians, or it was four black people, three Asians and one white.
Went in a bar.
I know there was one white.
Actually, it's been claimed that two of the individuals and other people haven't come forward because there may not be any more who were part of the review and they were their names are written in the review and they were not part of the review.
Okay, yeah, this is people that they've said they've sourced or they've said sourced they've gone to
information blah, blah, blah. Yeah.
Not the actual heads, but yes, people that they've said the I guess these six people said they've spoken to, or six or eight, I can't remember what it is, said they spoke to. They said, no, you didn't speak to me and you put your name in a report and I didn't give you any information or anything like that.
So that should tell them a little something about what is going on. You know, it's a big load of bollocks really, isn't it? You know what I mean?
That's why I don't care about it. It's just so ridiculously stupid.
So it's come to pass that...
I just wanted to hear what people thought about it, to be honest. That's why I put it in the group. Not so much that I have got the biggest opinion of it, to be honest.
Okay, so what they said was that to Britain, although having racist things in it, doesn't mean it's a racist country. Mm-hmm. And institutionalized racism, it does not exist in the UK any longer.
Mm.
And we should be a beacon, or we are a beacon, as in the Britain is a beacon to other Western countries for what race relations is like, because we're doing basically better than the rest of Europe and America, basically, in terms of how we are as a multicultural society.
But I think this, I mean, all of those wordings are like quite clever. And I don't want to do a comparison with who's got the highest grade of racism right now, but...
High grade.
The high grade, exactly. But one of the things that I think most people who have experienced the UK will tell you about racism in the UK is that it's very well packaged. In America, it's quite easy for you to hear the N-word and somebody call you the N-word. And not all the time the person who's calling you the N-word is of a different... You get what I'm saying to you? But in the UK, I don't think it's as blatant and it's as obvious. So the UK is very good at using turns of phrases that are inherently racist against you without you necessarily knowing that, you know, racism is happening. So we're a lot more mature in our ability to do racism. So when they say that institutionalized racism no longer exists, I find it very difficult to understand what they mean. Because yes, I'm less likely to hear somebody use the N-word, but we have politicians saying nigger in a woodpile and using these kind of like terminologies. And if a politician isn't part of the institution, then I don't know what is. You get what I'm saying to you?
Mm.
We have statistics, loads of them, especially around policing, that speak to the idea that there is a convergence of black and minority ethnic people being assigned to certain types of crimes, although those figures are in very specific boroughs that also happen to have a majority of black and minority ethnic people in there. And then they sell that story nationally, which doesn't kind of like speak to anybody in Wales, for example. But because television is programming, they're telling you, okay, you know, knife crime, black people do knife crime. If they're not being specific and saying black people in London are committing knife crime, or they're not being specific and saying black people in the boroughs of London where a majority of black people are committing, like, if you put things into context, it makes a little bit more sense. So that's where the institutionalized racism comes from. We still have the problem with jobs. Your name on your CV or your resume determines whether or not you even get to one of the stages of a job, because if a hiring manager decides that they can't pronounce your name easily and they're not going to put in the effort to learn it, you then get overlooked. It becomes somebody else, irrespective of what your graduation statistics are. So as far as the institutionalized stuff is concerned, it's definitely still there. It's bullshit, but I'm trying to figure out why. Why have they come out with this now, and what's the distraction?
It's pandering, basically. You're just trying to talk to a demographic of people to make them feel at ease, to say, look, we are not a racist nation, we're not a racist country. We do love everybody. We're unified, we're multicultural, we welcome everybody, but yet we still oppress a certain amount of people.
I think they want to incite violence, if I'm being honest with you, because yeah. The timing is coming towards summer again.
And it's coming towards the anniversary of George Floyd's passing as well.
Yeah, so I'm skeptical. I don't know what the point. I don't know what the point of it was. I know they did the commission, like you said, when we were doing the protest, and they have to kind of like show results for the exercise. But I don't know, this result, then the way they've done it, they've got a black man to come out and say it. So, you know, it's
kind of make it feel easier.
Yeah, it's supposed to come better coming from you. And then all of a sudden, I've seen so many black politicians on TV now talking about the same thing, saying, you know, it's been taken out of context. But the thing that's consistent with all of those black politicians is that they're all conservatives. So it's just, I don't know, it's a ruse.
Yeah, because the Labour ones and the other ones and the Libs ones are saying, no, it's a nonsense. So that's why those are the ones you're seeing are saying that.
Yeah.
I kind of agree with Wahala that is, I'm not that bothered. But then on the other hand, there will be like, if the results came a different way, then there will be actions that apparently they should take. So those actions don't have to be taken. If we don't have an institutionalized racist country, we don't need to set any rules. We don't need to look in that down these avenues. We don't need to implement anything because there's nothing to implement. So in those regards, I would have hoped for a more realistic, serious and honest, you know, report, which I don't think we got. I haven't read the report, but just going by the headlines, you know, it doesn't seem like it was a sensible thing.
Now, I think also there is, they did this with the railways. Like throughout Europe, everybody did a massive investment and upgraded their railways and stuff, and we didn't bother here. They either built from fresh and built new, or they upgraded massively, and we just didn't bother in this country.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't bother, not to the same level anyway. And so a lot of our infrastructure, as far as railways are concerned, is fairly old. Aside from the new H2 stuff that they're building, but the pre-existing stuff hasn't really been updated. It's been maintained, and it's that same kind of attitude. It's just that, oh, it's not broke, so don't fix it. But it's not broke for who? Do you get what I'm saying to you?
Mm.
So this now, where we are, all this Brexit and all the rest of it now, where we're kind of like a proper island now. These are the pitfalls that come with that status, as far as I'm concerned.
Anybody in the crowd want to say your two pence before we get wrapped up?
Yes, D, be brave, 52 weeks later. Following what Simple Simon said and Webslinger, I believe, okay, the timing of this report, because the George Floyd trial is happening currently right now, I think it's perfect timing for this report to be pushed out. So going by, okay, the protest that occurred last summer, so they know, okay, that the UK is going to be watching America. So for them, okay, to publish this report to show, okay, that the UK isn't racist, I think it will put those, okay, that were unsure about racism in the UK, I think they'll put their mind at ease that, okay, we're not as bad, okay, as other countries. Actually, we're a beacon. also with the person that got killed by a police officer, Sarah Everard. Mm. There was a kind of like a, I think, a feeling amongst the kid, like women, okay, oh, do you know what? Police brutality is actually real. So these are non-black women. And so for basically to kind of like not get the wave of that to coincide, okay, with institutionalized racism, I think, okay, it was like the perfect response to say, yep, the UK is not racist. There's no institutionalized racism. And I think the person that headed the inquiry, Tony Sewell,
yep,
I think it was like 10 years ago, he put it on, it was quoted in the newspaper that he said, okay, that institutionalized racism doesn't exist. So for him, okay, to come into this with that mindset, which is over 10 years back, I don't think we could have expected any other outcome. I think there was I think as Stavros said, okay, there was a couple of Asian people in who organized this report as well, and I know one of them again said, okay, there's no institutionalized racism, and that it was more to do, okay, with absent like parents and
I think that was actually Tony Sewell that said the absent fathers play as much a role to play as a institutionalized racism in terms of the issues that we as a black people face.
And he's right. Sorry, go ahead.
But I think there was an Asian woman, okay, that actually said similar things.
Okay, my bad.
Again, she's Tory, so it's not that much of a surprise. It wasn't Pretty Patel.
Well, we can say it's her just in case.
look, not all Asians are the same, okay? But I think, I can't remember the woman's name, but I know, okay, she is, it's to do, okay, with, she has a position to do with, like, racial justice and such, and that people were kind of upset when she got that position.
It speaks to the fact that you've mentioned two people who have had opinions about institutionalized racism.
They've had previous
from a long time ago. They've now been put into positions that they're part of this committee, which we would probably argue is, you know, similar to putting, a pedophile in charge of child care services.
Like, you
wouldn't do it. It just doesn't make any sense.
If you had people that were vehemently saying that racism exists, institutionalized racism is rife in the British society, and they put those on people on,
I would have a problem with that as well, because it's an easy bias. Say,
like, look at that, of course they did it. Well, but then you'd agree with what they said.
Yeah, but I would also be able to say that that's quite biased, and that you don't do that. Like, you put people there that you don't know their opinion at all, or you put people there that you know their opinion, but you're able to create a committee of people that may not necessarily agree entirely. Like, you need the diversity of ideas and the diversity of thought. If we had on this podcast, if we always agreed with each other with every single subject, it would be boring. The beauty comes in our disagreement and being able to put our point across for our disagreement. We learn and we push and we grow because of those differences. The same thing happening with this committee. You can't have a subject as big as institutionalized racism and then have a number of members on the committee who have already classically stated, at a time when other parts of society have already admitted that there was institutionalized racism. The McPherson report said that there was institutionalized racism. That's what happened with the Stephen Lawrence. They called it,
in particular, in the police force. Yeah, not in the.
But again, that's still part of the institution, so it's still institutionalized. It's a major part of the institution. So you can't tell me on one hand the institution is saying, yes, there is institutionalized racism. Then you've got these people in the same time period saying there is no racism. And then we later on come back now to have them on a committee for institutionalized racism. You got me? It's like,
just wait till someone racially abuses them, then they'll say it, man.
they're probably
in the workplace.
I've heard a lot of them talk. They've said they've experienced racism. They said racism exists, but institutionalized racism doesn't.
Until it's said in their workplace, their face.
They're just doing going by
in the pub, wherever.
They're going by the thingy lines.
Nee, you want to say anything before we go?
The findings are very intentional. Same with the whole the bill to put a stop to people being allowed to protest. They kind of just want to cripple black people's ability to organize and elevate ourselves. If you put the idea that there's no institutional racism and that the outcome is actually based on culture, that in itself, you know, is a racist idea that, yeah, you know, there are these silly black people, of course they're not doing well in school because they're black. It's nothing to do with the schools, or there's the reason they're getting excluded more than anyone else is because they're black and their culture. It's nothing to do with the institution itself. So I think it's just, it's a very intentional thing to sort of make us feel as though we have no ability to really improve our situation because they're not willing to accept their role in it. And, you know, getting black faces to spit out this rubbish is, you know, it's like they're getting people that are like physicists and things like that to talk on race. Just because you're black doesn't make you an expert on race. You know, you're not a social scientist. You don't have if you don't have the particular expertise, I don't see why you'd be put on that commission. And obviously with Tony Sewell, he's also coming in with his own already pre-established beliefs about institutional racism. But yeah, it's not surprising to look on the people that were part of the commission and seeing OBE, MBE, all these kind of things and their attachment to the system that they're talking about not being racist. It's again, Britain loves to gaslight black people. Britain loves to make black people invisible and then entrench their suffering and pretend like they're not doing it on purpose. And even I saw it even more like an insidious thing as well was they tried to sort of pit Africans and West Indians against each other within the report, talking about Africans being amongst the higher achievers in schools. And therefore, you know, it must be something to do with West Indian culture that's making them lag behind. And I think it's very, you have to be very careful, isn't it? Because I've seen the same rhetoric in the USA and the way that's causing fragmentation between new West African migrants in the USA and African Americans. We can't allow that to be used to create the same fragmentation with 100%, West Africans 100%. And West Indians here. It's very easy to see through this what they're trying to do. So it's just one of those things where they really want to disenfranchise us to the highest capability of their they want to disenfranchise us to their highest capabilities. So we have to make sure that they don't do that.
Yes. Okay. Just to be fair, they also said that social economical values and attributes contributes just as much as race. I think they're quite heavy on that. So it's like your class is just a bigger thing as race. And I think sometimes it is as well. So I do want to just add that bit on there because I think it's important. All right. So Nee and D, who are the last men standing on stage. I'm going to let you say goodbye quickly, and then I'm going to lock you off. We're going to say our goodbyes because my battery's going to die. So I'll kick you off, and you can hear what we say when
the episode is.
Yeah, tomorrow. All right, so start off with Nee. Let Nee go first. If you just want to say goodbye or whatever, it's up to you.
No, peace.
Thank you very much for joining us. It's always good to hear your voice.
Look, panda there.
D. Yes, it's D, 52 weeks later. You can catch me on 52 weeks later on Twitter, 52 weeks later on Instagram, D Brave on Clubhouse, and I've got a website, 52weekslater.com, which is all about my book that I'm currently writing about my travels around Asia, mainly Japan. It was good to be on this episode. Take it easy. Happy Easter, guys.
Plug it.
All right. Thank you for everyone in the room. Thank you for joining us. Hopefully we'll see you do this again another time. I'm going to close this room now.
Thank you.
Whilst we say our goodbyes. Peace, guys. All right. And as for us in the room, let's do our church notes and our goodbyes.
All right. At Big Wahala Insta, Big Wahala on Twitter. Check out At One Stop Dreadlock for your hair care needs and your do-rags and your swimming caps and your head ties and whatnot. So yeah, check that out. And just want to say...
Welcome to the ESN Podcast.
Okay. Just want to say get better to DMX.
Yeah.
He's currently brain... They said that he's at the moment he's got no brain signal and he's in a vegetative state. It's not looking good at the moment. He's had a heart attack due to what they believe maybe a drug overdose. It's not looking good for him at the moment, but I'm hoping that he can pull through this and hopefully change his life around again. It's very, very sad situation that's going on with him at this present moment in time. So just prayers for DMX and hopefully he'll get through this situation.
Simple Simon.
At Simple Simon FB on Twitter. I don't have Instagrams this week. I don't know what it is. It's a guilty pleasure of mine. And there's a tune that just keeps ringing in my head. So when you get a chance, have a listen. I'll give you a little intro now quickly. Volume me up on there, please. Yeah, this tune here is by DJ Tunes and Jay Anthony. It is called Differently. And
we're too long, we're too strong. Might as well let it run then. But you can talk.
Yeah, so this is the tune underneath me here. The lyrics are terrible, but I don't know what it is. It's a vibe and I'm feeling it. Anyway, that's all I got to plug this week. Go good, my people. Gaza.
DJ, Web Slinger.
Yeah, what's good, people? Thanks for listening. Thank you for the clubhouse. DJ Web Slinger on Instagram, DJ Web Slinger on Twitter. I think this week my spider sense is tingling over Tyler Perry's show, which is kind of old, called Ruthless. Kind of feeling it at the moment. I've been binging on that. I want to give a shout out to the family of Richard Okoroye, who went missing on the 22nd of March. I hope we do find him.
Yeah, safe and sound, man.
Safe and sound, Richard. If you're listening, by any chance, call your parents, call somebody, people care. And I'm looking for you. Alright, that's me. I'm out. See you in the next one.
Yes, I am Stavros Bus. You can catch me at Stavros Bus everywhere. You can also catch Mr. Wolf at aka _ Mr. Wolf somewhere and _ aka Mr. Wolf somewhere else. I can't remember which one is which. My Stavros says this week is a film called African Apocalypse, which is we wanted to show the violence of colonization is not limited to history. It continues to shape the modern world. When we first left, it's about colonization in Niger, in Africa. How the is it the French? The
Niger
French
or Niger?
Niger. How the French built roads, but had. They just did a madness there. And it's a film, I'll put the thing up. It's £10 to rent. I don't think you can buy it right now, but you can rent it. Support things like this. It's a documentary. Support it. Someone's actually gone there and spoken to the locals and spoken about the history of what's going on. Once again, that's African Apocalypse, and the link will be in the show notes. Thank you very much for tuning in to us this day. You can catch us collectively at ESN Podcast on all the social medias. Use the hashtag ESN Pod to start or join in the conversation. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, remember, if you ain't saying nothing, say it well.
Slag for life. She